Monday, September 25th, 2017. Our town clerk is here to help us with, to notarize a notarize an agreement at a no-cost extension. So I'd like to start with that, if the board is okay with that. All right, so if you recall, we have a grant from the New Hampshire DES, $409,000 and some change with regard to the fire engine. When we applied for that grant, it had an end date of September 30th. And so we had talked at the time saying that was just not going to work, couldn't do it, and I said, can we file a no-cost extension when we need to? And the word came back, yes. So this is the time to file the no-cost extension. And so it very simply says that this agreement between the town, this agreement here and after quality amendment, between, is buying between the state of New Hampshire and the town of Rollinsford. Through DES. Whereas pursuant to an agreement, here and after quality agreement, approved by the Governor and Executive Council on April 19th, 2017, Rollinsford agreed to perform certain services upon the terms and conditions specified in that agreement and consideration of payment by the state of certain sums as specified therein. And whereas Rollinsford and the state have agreed to amend the agreement in certain respects. So therefore, in consideration of the foregoing and the covenants and conditions contained in the agreement, blah, 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 the parties do hereby agree as follows. The amendment and modification of agreement is hereby amended as follows. The completion date listed in 1.6 of the general provisions shall be changed from September 30th, 2017 to March 31st, 2018. Everything else remains in full force and effect in accordance with the terms and conditions. And the effective date of the amendment is based on the approval of the Governor and Council. That's pretty much it. So, is the board, I'd like a motion from the board to agree to this time extension on our grant.
So moved.
Any discussion on this? I'll call the question. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so the amendment dated this, is it the 25th day? Of September. September 2017. Okay, so I am now going to sign this. The state of New Hampshire. The county of Stratford. Maybe we're supposed to do that.
Okay. And here's the additional form that goes with it, and Andrea sent you earlier.
All right, this does not go with it. This is
it,
this is different. This is a closing
okay.
document for bond counsel.
Okay.
Can I give this back to you? Can you give it to Caroline? So because
sure.
I don't want to
yeah,
be responsible.
That's fine.
Or we can put it in the folder, one of trouble.
No, I'll study it. Okay. You want me to give this to
Well, we'll put
Caroline
her, we'll put them both in the folders.
Okay.
We'll
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank
yeah.
you very much. That is it.
Awesome.
For coming. I appreciate
Thank you.
It. All right.
A hungry bear at home is getting late dinner.
All right, well, enjoy
yeah.
your dinner. You can have it outside, it's so warm. Oh,
oh
God,
no,
it's
I gotta
dark.
See.
All right, take care.
Yes, have a nice evening.
Thank
Good
you.
To see you.
Take care.
See you.
All right, so look, we'll start now with the approval of the minutes. So we have three sets. We had the non-public meeting on a week ago Monday in the morning. We had our regular meeting a week ago Monday, and we had a public hearing a week ago Monday. So, do you want to do these separately? Is everybody all set with all three?
I made just one adjustment to the.
And I read yours. I read them after you
okay.
made them. So,
what was it?
I think it was the public hearing.
Public hearing one, yeah, the
18th.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
All right. So, by consensus, Sally, we're with all three sets. Thank you.
I have a problem.
And your problem, Adam?
Well, on the public hearing, I really think that the guidelines should be able to be printed with it.
You can't print them.
I can print them, never mind that. I can't electronically put them with minutes.
Electronic minutes.
Yeah.
Understand. It takes, we haven't been able to figure out how best to do it, but to try to download it to my machine and put it in another form and then upload it again, it's a lot of hoopla. And if we find somebody else could do that, but if I'm the one that has to do it, I usually choose to find something else that's more important.
There's some software that's under $100 that would be able to.
All right, tell you what, the next time we're here together, maybe you can tell Caroline what that software is.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can install it so that, I mean, what's best is, you know, I make the links available to everything, so it would be best if people could just take those links and do what they think they need to do with it, so that I'm not having to invest more time in doing those sorts of things.
So if you provide the link, we can embed the link into the minutes to.
Apparently, no.
It's not working.
Well, I can, if I suppose I can do that.
I thought that was part of our issue.
Yeah, all right, I'll do that. It just looks so.
All right, community input? Tia, are you here to talk to us about Facebook?
I am, far away.
All right, you're on. You can either stay there, you can come up, whatever you feel comfortable doing, we're good.
So you said if it was important to me, I should come, so I'm here, so.
So, well, I can start with my version of it.
Okay.
So, you mean the town, through your help and your many, many hours, puts forth a really good town website with our new service for people, you know, as we post things, they, you know, we can all find out what gets posted and they can see it and they can also go to the website. The Facebook page is not anything that I pay attention to. And if it is an official town Facebook page, somebody on the authority should be looking at this thing, because we're personally liable if people post. So apparently people can post to this Facebook page.
They can reply and write a comment, but Joe, you followed it. Have you seen, I mean, the page has been there for 2 years. So have you ever noticed anything that's?
Well, it's not that, it's just the fact that people post a comment and a comment is posted back from the town, but it's not any of the three of us.
And the comment is always the same. The select board meets one night at 6:30. Please stop by and visit them and discuss.
No, the last one was the select board is under the impression Avatar is sending out the letters, blah, 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 blah.
And that was because I was on the phone with Caroline. So I
don't
think
that doesn't. No, I'm not saying. It's just not us.
Or, right. So, Tia, who do you, can I, I'm sorry, can
yeah.
I, I'm sorry.
Go right ahead.
No, go right ahead. Who do you think is using the Facebook page who wouldn't also be able to subscribe to the website and get that same information? What's the.
So, nobody uses email anymore, especially not as their primary source of information. Everybody uses social media.
But you. I'm not unfamiliar with that trend. I'm also not unfamiliar with some of the problems associated with social media and
right.
How people tell one thing from another thing. And the fact of the matter is the town just doesn't have the resources to manage both. And if someone posts something that tells us something we need to be aware of and we haven't seen it on what is, I guess, portrayed as an official town Facebook page, we have only a certain number of hours in which to respond, otherwise we're liable.
But I've been doing this for 10 years. I've been managing
our Facebook page,
the website stuff, all this stuff for 10 years. So what in that time has made you question whether or not I will come to you and ask for an appropriate response to give to this person?
It isn't you, Tia. It's not you. It's just that it should be situated within the town in order for the
right.
liability to line up with the folks who have the, where it's supposed to be.
And you're right that this isn't me, and I'm here advocating for a service that I don't really need because you send me everything I need to know. I'm advocating for everybody else. am advocating for the town, because when you ran, you said you wanted to make things more transparent. You said you wanted to get information out there. This is a way to do it, and that's the only reason I'm here, because I could personally care less if I have one more thing to do with the stuff you send me, but I'm advocating for the other people in town who use that service.
To ask a question, so are the, is, rather, is the Facebook page and the website linked, so every time you upload a new, so you have to physically go?
I could, but I don't have it that way. I have it so that I physically do it each time. And I have it that way on purpose.
Can we make it so that they cannot comment?
Sure.
And that they cannot, I don't know, is there a way to like not like it either? Because I think you always have the option.
Do you have to like it to follow it so you get the updates?
No, I like that part. But I mean, like everything that gets noticed, you can like, comment, and share.
Yeah.
And I like the share, but I'm afraid of the comments.
Yeah, it's the comments.
Because it's the comments that,
Postings. Because
I love the information, love it. And I do agree with Tia that, but I would appreciate if one of us was an administrator to that. Like, I'm an administrator to certain Facebook pages, and so I can see who posts, and if I need to delete something, I can, or something to that effect.
But if we can arrange it so that there is no posting ability, that removes that, doesn't it?
We can turn off comments. That way, that solves our problem, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Like people, if you're just, it's not rocket, regurgitate is not the right word, but if you're just reposting,
which,
wrong read.
That's essentially what it is.
Yeah, I mean, that to me makes sense, but it's the comments that
could
be liable
for. It's the comments that we don't see.
And direct it to, the official page.
Official town website is such and such.
But if they want to reach us, it doesn't go to the select board. So could we put that?
I don't know.
Where are you looking to, so I understand what you want to change specifically?
Right on the page.
Yep.
I think that's what it's called again.
Send message.
Is it just the town of Rollins, or is that what it is?
It's just town of Rollins.
Town of Rollins.
Gives our hours and our address.
I'm trying to log back in, so I'm going to trust the two of you to sort of manage this.
So I just sent a message to the page.
Okay.
And that looks like goes through Messenger.
It does.
Okay.
So I'll have to look into how we can change that. The only other thing would be, you can post an away message. So like an auto reply.
Oh, great.
That's it. And you can send me whatever text you'd like put there.
Yeah, people like that.
I'm sorry, but I like what?
Essentially, to equate it to email, you can add like an auto reply.
So a send message ends up in Messenger. So if you hit it, she can have an auto reply.
Oh, I see.
Select board, blah, 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 blah.
Okay.
Select board at us.gov.
Yep.
That
works.
Helpful.
And then
as well as turning off comments.
Yeah.
The like, I don't, that doesn't make any difference to me.
Yeah.
People can use that. It's the comments. So.
Do we have an agreeable solution?
I think we do.
Okay.
So all you do is reposting stuff from email.
Correct.
From the website.
Correct.
And then we'll turn the comments off. And if is there a splash page or some introductory something that maybe we should put a blurb up that would?
You can pin a post to the top, so you can put something that always appears at the top of the page.
Is there anything there right now?
There is not.
All right, so if we have time, maybe we can just put some nice little something up there.
Sure.
I mean, I'll think about that.
Okay.
So thank you.
I
like it.
I was just afraid of not being able to comment
back,
and then
the
they think we're ignoring them.
Yes.
That was my fear.
Yeah.
Right. Right. Depending on what it is that they are trying to tell us. All right. I think we're good. Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Appreciate it.
All right. Have a nice evening, enjoy summer.
Thanks.
All right, any other community input? Yes, Em?
I'm here tonight, Celia Leopold, on behalf of the Historical Committee to let the board know.
Indeed.
That last Monday, the Historical Committee submitted a request to the state on behalf of the Pear Yard School to put it on the 7 to 8 list. We are still waiting to hear whether or not we will be nominated to the list. And while doing research, the chairperson of the Historical Committee found out that in 1938, the town report shows the Pear Yard School was bought by the Lampieces family. And that's not, so it's not even town property, it's personal property. And so the homeowner, or the current landowner, has worked with the Historical Committee to complete the forms necessary. And he does have a few drawbacks about what he'd like to see done with it in the future, so we, as a committee.
You mean drawback, you mean constraints, or?
He would like to see it off of his property if it's going to be open to the public, because he's worried about liability and tax issues and so forth. So the Historic Committee is working on possible other locations and strategies for dealing with those problems.
It's the New Hampshire Preservation Alliance, it's the 7 to 8, it's not the state, so.
Sorry.
And it's basically just a better word, a PR mechanism, basically, to help raise funds, through other organizations, to help raise funds.
Yeah, they spoke at the SRPC.
I mean, they're a great organization.
Yeah.
But Mr. Lampieces, I think ultimately would like to see, to have the old school donated back to the town, but then removed from his property.
Yes.
So.
Yeah.
And that's a conversation, a long-range conversation to have, but I think it's great that the committee has been a local landowner to preserve it.
No, it's excellent. So thank you for that little report, I appreciate it. And I see that we have some highway department heads here, and Tom is here to talk to us about the housing standards. And I get logged out doing this. No, I'm not back in. So I'm trying to get back in, however. Give me just a minute. So Chief and Tom, do you care in which order we do this?
I don't
care. You were here first, Chief. You were there. As far as I'm concerned, I just got
4 or 5 minutes.
Good, Tom.
Well, do you have the...
No, you don't want to hear this.
So the three of you may have input on all on the minimum housing standards, for the life safety issues associated with it. So
that makes you go first.
So Tom, yes, let's do this. Is that where...
Come on.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Does anyone have the...
Do I have a printed copy?
Yeah, I do.
With the...
Not with your comments, so just with the... It's a red line word, but not with your comments.
Did you happen to print them out?
I did.
That's what happens when...
That's why I need to print it out, the comment.
Listen.
I couldn't get through.
Sign me back in. I'm getting there. Just
okay.
Give me 2 minutes. Please. 2 minutes.
Meanwhile.
Back at the ranch.
Can I talk about Church Street while they're looking?
Please, yes.
Oh, okay.
So that's what it used to look like.
Yes.
From
I was,
Google. So it's the front where they took out the sidewalk.
Yeah, it was kind of chipped up, and he kind of put it back. I mean, it's just, it's very rough installation of additional concrete. It was all broken up, so he pulled it back. I'm hearing this after the fact, of course. It was all broken up, so he pulled it back and then reinstalled. Just looks like he just mixed the concrete like in a wheelbarrow or something.
Right.
But I don't, it doesn't look like it's any more than what was there, and it's.
But the picture shows the sidewalk. If you look at the front, if you look at the front view of the house, there's a sidewalk with a granite curb, isn't there?
Oh, I don't, we're talking here, right?
So this is where they put in the driveway.
Yeah.
And then this is what they took out, now in that picture.
Well, that's that, this, but this part that comes around is still there.
Oh, it has a big hole. There's a big.
Those two other part they took out was one right in front, parallel to church, like right in here. The rest of this appears to be untouched. Well, I'll be happy to go back and look, but I didn't think it was to that extent.
We'll just take it. Stay there, we're just accepting some material. Thank you, George.
Okay, thank you.
Have a nice evening.
The driveway to the right, however, I think might be an issue, because it was just worn. And he dug it out and installed, where the fence here is. Just worn there, he dug it out and installed a gravel driveway.
And from what I understand, there's like a two-bedroom and a studio and a three-bedroom.
There's five units in it, and.
Were there always five units?
Yeah, yes. He did the renovations pretty much just to, you know, it's pretty much mostly cosmetic. And he had a separate electrical permit to separate the service for two units, because two of them are on one panel. So that's a good thing, but for the most part, it's just cosmetic, linoleum painting. It looks great. I mean, I think it looks way better than it used to. The outside stuff, especially the driveway, you know, we have a provision in the zoning ordinance that talks about you can't do anything basically without a permit. And it says, it doesn't say specifically driveway, but it does say grading, paving, excavation. So if he digs it out, digs that along and installs a gravel drive.
He should have had a permit.
Well.
He didn't pave it.
Perhaps, right. Because if you look in these two regulations, which are the subdivision and site review, they both have driveway standards, but he didn't go to the site review, he didn't go to the subdivision. So are these applicable?
Because it's not a, it's a redevelopment and a development.
Right. And as you point out, he didn't pave it, so it might be a.
We have some, clearly, you know, we're not watertight.
True.
You know, we've had a driveway question on Boundary.
Yep.
This is another driveway question. I won't say issue, I'll just say question. Yeah. So.
Well, I'm sure he would bring in, if we told him to, bring in a permit application for the installation of the driveway.
Okay.
Then.
Then what?
Right. Would we just issue it and say fine, or would we say, you know, it has to comply with specific regulations relating to driveways?
Does it? Does it happen? Do you think it would?
Well, there are setbacks, which would be most important from an abutment perspective, I would think. But a lot of those are for drainage, and I mean, this is gravel. He hasn't paved it, so I don't know if it would be a huge impact.
I was just wondering about what he cut out, or they cut out, too, because I got the call from a neighbor.
In the front.
Right, and what they cut out, was is that going to affect the drainage into that property that already has issues? Come to find out, there's no catch basin at the bottom of that street.
Right.
So. All right. That's bad. The setback for the old Salmon Falls district is what? The average of the two or three sides, whatever the.
Yeah.
So.
That relates
it's vague, so.
Right, but.
3 inches or.
Well, that's just it, right? So.
That does
driveway work. Fall under, cutting a driveway into there would fall under that?
I don't think we would apply table of dimensional regulations to driveway installations in the,
in site, right.
Site,
I didn't bring
yeah,
that
right.
Of course.
Right. mentions, I think the subdivision refers to the site plan, and the site plan type requirements page. Page 3, way in the back. It talks about the driveways, intersections, but it appears most of this relates to driveways like in subdivisions and paved driveways. I would, I guess respectfully suggest when we get a highway guy in, he might have more experience. You know, as far as interest in driveways, pavers, or gravel. And we may have to do some modifications, amendments, or something to one of these to be really clear about.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think the issue with driveways is kind of, this is the second time we've sort of been blindsided by a, an additional driveway.
Right.
So we should maybe table this and have another conversation.
We could. I mean, at the end of the, you know, the, we could take kind of a hard angle and say to the guy, you didn't get a permit, so restore it until we get this resolved. But I'm not, you know, I mean, he is providing off-street parking for a five-unit building, and he did lease some spaces across the street from the railroad. Mm-hmm. So he's, you know, he's trying to get him off the street.
Right. Which is commendable.
Right.
And he's being responsive, right? I mean,
oh, yes.
Everything
yeah.
else. So.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
So, I'm fine with that. It's just the drainage issue that came up with the other cutting of the paper.
Yep.
So, I was looking for a catch basin and couldn't find it.
So, we've noted that. We know that we want to, when we do the village, that we should perhaps.
I'm sure didn't take out a catch basin.
Yeah, no.
No, I mean, there's nothing there.
No,
this one, that's a problem.
No, it's not the fact that there's not there, it's going to make
the
problem worse.
No, right.
Makes the drainage. It just doesn't help the drainage. All right,
exactly. So we'll, if I were to front of the satisfactory.
So we'll hold tight on this for the time being?
Yeah.
Now, related to this, in the red folder, is a certificate of occupancy for this five-year building that closes out the permit for the renovations.
So it's been empty.
It's been empty, yes. Yes, it's all
oh right. Yeah, this was the one that had a dumpster at one point.
Oh, it was
okay.
Shape and the.
So it's been updated.
Oh yes. Yes.
No, those are all good news.
Oh,
that's
right.
Good news for the village district.
It looks way better, and he would like permission, you know, to list it to start renting it. And I suggested that doing a certificate of occupancy, because we did have a related building permit for renovations.
Okay.
Would be the way to do it.
Okay. All right, so we will process that one.
Okay.
We'll do that later on.
But I'll also mention to him that the driveway thing is outstanding question.
And maybe an issue with the sidewalk, too.
Yes.
True, right, yes. Yes.
Okay, that would be perfect if you could relate that to me.
Yeah.
Shall we do the minimum housing standards? I now have it in front of me with the edits.
So before you lose it.
Yes, I know. I didn't lose it. I did lose it. All right. So, did you have any overarching comments about anything when you read it?
More, you know, specific to certain pages.
I had some specific issues. I don't know if anybody else had. Should we just kind of go through them specifically?
I think so.
All right.
My first suggestion is page numbers.
Yes. Good idea. We would do page numbers.
Okay, very helpful.
Yes. We will do page numbers.
So why don't, what were your questions?
Well, some of them were just kind of semantic. Like I've got in defensive offices and employees.
That
no, 20, no officer employee at the town of Rollinsford, active for the town of Rollinsford, discharged of his duties. Shouldn't that, isn't that used to say in the discharge of his duties? Okay, so I'm going to make that change. Yes.
Or you could just delete that phrase after Rollinsford and before shall, because it goes on and pointing out to say, as a result of
in
the discharge of his duties.
Oh, I see, yeah.
So it's kind of redundant.
So we'll just get rid of it.
Okay.
think that does make sense.
Not the entire.
No, 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 no.
Section, just the first sentence.
If, so, no officer or employee of the town of Rollinsford acting for the town of Rollinsford with respect to this ordinance, so we'll get rid of the.
Discharged.
Of his duties. With respect to this ordinance.
Yep.
Shall render himself personally liable for any damage that may accrue to any person or property as a result of his acts in the discharge of his duties. So it was a, it was extraneous verbiage. All right, then the next.
On the same page.
Yes.
I noticed you really, you wanted to swap most of boards, like on the select board, but under administration, 01-8A, it still says board of selectmen.
Yeah, it also says, I think I have the whole thing highlighted because it names the standards board, the housing standards board shall consist of four members, namely the health officer, fire chief, building inspector, and a member of the select board. What's wrong with that statement?
Well, the only thing that I can see is that my duties overlap, but that wasn't always the case.
Yeah.
It may not always be the case.
Right, so.
I don't personally see that there's an issue.
Okay, so we'll just leave it four?
That's what I think.
Okay, okay, very good.
I didn't change that, so you want to change it, so select four, I just left it the way.
I did, I changed all the others.
Okay.
Yeah, but I had it, I didn't bother with this one because I had a question that encompassed it. So then, under responsibilities of owner and occupants, so this is something I really wanted us to chat about to make sure we were sure about what it is that we were saying. So it says, in premises containing more than four dwelling units, the owner shall supply garbage disposal facilities or garbage disposal containers for all dwelling units. That's under responsibilities of owner. So if you've got four, at least four units, you have to supply.
Either a dumpster or a garbage can, is the way I read that.
Yes, so do we have people who do not have such, and will they be surprised by this? In other words, they own four more units and don't supply this.
The only one that I know of for sure is on South Street. And the gentleman has come in and talked to us before.
He's the one.
He provides dumpsters, I mean, he doesn't have room for a dumpster, but he provides garbage cans, I think they're covered.
Okay.
I don't.
So does that?
I have one on Highland, I don't know.
Okay.
The four-unit complex.
Do they provide a dumpster or not?
I don't see a dumpster.
So they would have to at least provide garbage can.
So does that seem a good number, good, I mean, four?
It's four, then, I didn't change the number either, this is all.
But like with Dover, yeah.
Yeah.
Further on, the requirements of occupants for, you know, one and two and whatever, and they don't have to be a dumpster, but they have to have garbage containers, so. I think this is a good one that it's the owner that has to provide it for the tenants. And it would also, of course, apply to this Church Street. You have five units, so.
Who is he gonna put a dumpster?
Oh, probably not, but he'll probably do garbage can, maybe in the driveway.
But at the very least, they need to provide garbage cans, because there are certain properties in the village where garbage is piled up on porches.
Yes.
And it's an issue with vermin, and it's unsightly, and.
Yeah.
It's a recipe for disease in the summertime, at least.
Okay, so we're good with the four units, okay, that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So C, this was the infestation, my question was, does it say that if it only happens in one unit, the owner's not responsible, is that the result of this? Of the way this is stated? Wherever infestation is caused by failure of the owner to maintain a dwelling in a rat-proof or reasonably insect-proof condition, or wherever infestation exists in two or more of the dwelling units, extermination shall be the responsibility of the owner. So, can the owner, in this particular case in question, it was one unit, at least it started out as one unit, and the owner really said, it's not, I didn't do anything. So.
So we just change that to?
I don't know, I don't, I mean, it seems to me that that particular situation would not have been the responsibility of the owner until it went to another unit, is that?
I think you're exactly right, that's what this says.
Yep, And is that okay? And that may be fine.
Well, I don't see why not. I mean, if a lot of the bed bug stuff comes from, you know, people taking furniture that's left for free on a curb or something and looks serviceable, but they bring in bed bugs.
So in that case, those people are responsible for taking your problem?
For their own unit.
For their own unit.
So now what happens if that one unit, they decide to leave, and they leave an infestation that's just in one unit? At that point, who's responsible?
I'm pretty sure that if it's left in one unit, it's going to go to more than one.
So you just wait?
An owner, I would think, for the most part, couldn't want any of it. And if the tenant did not take, or the occupant didn't take the necessary steps, I know this example may not work very well.
Well, we did have some difficulty.
We did.
You know?
Yes.
Which is what prompted us to want to do this. So, but at the very least, we could say that person can't rent it out.
I think we could at least say that. And this does talk about the failure of the owner to maintain it causes infestation. So, I mean, it's not his or her failure if the tenant brings in, you know, some infested couch or something.
So, but at the point where that tenant leaves, now it is the owner. I guess then and Dees kind of says that the owner of a dwelling containing more than one dwelling unit shall be responsible for maintaining all units in compliance with applicable health, fire, and safety code.
Right.
So at that point, the owner is trying to rent the apartment. Well, you've got to bring it now. So
good point. Yep.
All right.
Yep.
Okay. I think I'm
probably covered then. Okay.
Great. Thank you.
So if we go on from the garbage,
where are you taking us?
I'm going back.
Back to what?
I don't like to look next. And maybe it's in here and I'm just not remembering somewhere else in this code for garbage.
There's a mention of garbage and
garbage,
rubbish,
right?
Which prompted my question about garbage, rubbish.
I'll wait till we get to that because I think they're, maybe it's occupancies.
It's further on. Definitely.
Yeah, I'm just thinking of even the village district, I'm thinking of Rollins Road. This residence apparently that it has trying to be charitable, a dump in their backyard, or refuse pit that shouldn't happen in their backyard. I want to make sure these standards.
And they're multi-unit too.
They're not supposed to be.
I think.
We have that covered elsewhere in zoning. They're not allowed to be multi-unit.
Right.
So.
I think.
But.
This would definitely cover that situation.
Okay. So that's a situation that's long overdue from being settled. So if this is going to give you extra tools,
That is with the attorney right now. I don't know exactly where.
Yeah.
So if it could, are we good to keep going on? So under Article 3 minimum standards, I just question what these asterisks refer to.
Yes. They come from the Dover ordinance when they added a new section. They had an asterisk, and at the bottom, said what date it was.
Did I not take them all out? I thought I took them all out.
Oh, I don't know. This is one asterisk
one.
And two. So we just need to take them
it's
out.
It's possible that I missed one or two. I'm sorry.
Oh.
There were a lot more actually.
That's easy. I'll just say
if you look back, so look at my paper copy of everything. See where it goes back. And so when these were,
they're like here.
Yes.
Okay.
So this is the working copy.
Yes.
That Vern sent us, so I just printed it out.
Remove
and
asterisks.
So he would strike the reference at the bottom that it didn't remove an asterisk. Right.
All right.
I mean that's
okay.
All.
All right.
But,
thank you.
And that
but you
can
see as a reader, as a reader, you see.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Where were we? Asterisk. Okay. We handle the asterisks. And so in that same Article 3, we're talking about minimum standards. If you go down there, numbers 1, 2, and 3. So it's C. I guess it's C3. It's talking about water closets, lavatory basins, bathtub, shower shall be in good working condition and properly connected to a water and sewer system approved by the Housing Standards Board and consistent with regulations of the water and sewer district. Is that just for dwellings in the water and sewer district, or is it, do they have some say, or do we just want everybody to use the regulations that they have? Do you understand my question?
I do, and I think the water sewer district would probably just be applicable to those units, but we would want any dwelling unit, I think, in the town to be connected to an approved water and sewer system, which would be, of course, private well and septic. So perhaps.
Do we just put a period approved by the Housing Standards Board?
That, I think, would be a good idea.
Okay, so approved by the Housing Standards Board, period, comma, or if, or within the water and sewer district, consistent with regulation of the water, relevant to water and sewer district.
Well, do they have, does the district have?
Do they have that? Do they do that?
Well, if, I mean, if you wanted to put that, it would just essentially split the responsibility for enforcement.
So.
We say.
Well, because, I mean, they're a separate entity, they should have authority over, they do have authority over who gets hooked up and how they get hooked up.
Right.
Their system, so.
But this, I think, is addressed more to the fixtures within the unit.
Just the fixtures within, okay.
We want to make sure that they're all in working order.
Okay.
Portable water, you know, functioning sewer, whether it be private or municipal.
So, but I've just, so here's, maybe this isn't necessary based on what you just said, but what I've added is such, you know, the sentence starts out, sewer system approved by the Housing Standards Boards, semicolon, or consistent with regulations of the Rollinsford Water and Sewer District for dwelling units in the Rollinsford Water and Sewer District. Mm-hmm.
So replace and with or? Is that what you just?
Right, so like it's splitting the responsibility, so if they're in the.
That works. Well, I still would maintain though that they may not have the authority to go into a dwelling unit and say, is your tub working or.
Yeah, reading it again, I think so. Right, yeah.
So just put a period.
That's what I think.
Because we're not talking about the connection of the street, we're talking about the interior.
All right, so we'll just put a period. Thank you, that works. All right, so F and G, one talks about rubbish storage facilities, the other garbage disposal facilities. What's the difference between rubbish and garbage? I'll confess, I kind of use them synonymously. Is there a glossary of terms?
There is a list of definitions, but those aren't included. But yes. I believe that rubbish would be stuff like paper goods, where garbage is
municipal solid waste.
Yeah, or food, you know.
Municipal solid waste.
Yeah.
Okay. Is that the?
I think that's the term that we use in our consistent with the statutes, with our transfer station.
But okay.
Well, when you say municipal solid waste, I mean, if I have a bag of garbage outside that has, you know, chicken bones and it's ripped over by
a dog,
is that municipal solid waste, or is that mine?
Well, oh, not, no, no.
We don't
no.
Need it.
So,
the town.
I'm sorry.
Oh,
that's
okay.
Solid waste.
Okay.
Solid waste.
So that would.
Rather than garbage, solid waste.
Okay.
I mean, I think I need a better terms than rubbish and garbage because I certainly don't know the difference. But we mean in the first instance, rubbish is non-solid waste.
Okay.
Like plastics, newspapers,
yes.
The things we would put
yeah.
in the recycle
or
bin.
Construction
bin,
perhaps.
Yeah, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
Whereas.
I think you just say, don't just get rid of rubbish. Just say garbage. I think everyone understands what garbage is.
Just get rid of F altogether?
No, no, I don't think you have to get rid of it. I just instead of saying rubbish store, just say garbage storage.
Then what's the difference between F and G?
Every dwelling unit shall have adequate garbage disposal facilities or garbage storage containers.
F says the same thing, but with reference to rubbish.
One of them says sewers and one says disposal. Adequate rubbish storage facilities versus at the garbage disposal facility.
I mean, they were talking about attracting vermin.
Yeah. I don't understand why we need both, which I don't.
Can we just get rid of that?
There's gotta be a reason Dover did it though, so I don't wanna.
Well, I'm trying to think of an example, but this applies to when I came.
Well.
You'll put it in a hole.
Yes.
We're gonna have a hearing.
I'm just gonna highlight.
And so if that comes up, or, I mean, even after the hearing, we can amend it and.
Yeah.
To make those changes, so.
You guys are gonna be sorry you didn't go first.
We're only on page four.
Well, we can stop and come back to it.
Because you would miss the great garbage debate, so.
You know, we could continue, is there a lot more that we had?
You're the one who had, you had the questions, so I'm.
Oh, all right, the next one is under space use and location, number 13, I think.
Yes.
Number four under that, no cooking or eating shall be permitted in any sleeping room in any dwelling or dwelling unit, and no cooking facility or appliance shall be permitted in any sleeping room. I don't have trouble legislating cooking facilities and appliances in a sleeping room, or cooking, it's the eating. Do we really wanna legislate that people should be eating in their bedroom?
I'm in big trouble.
Seriously?
I just always read that as one thing, and, but yeah, if you separate them, you're right.
The libertarian in me looks at that and says, the town has no telling me where to eat my food.
Correct.
I could eat it upside down, I could eat it in my bedroom, I could, you know.
This is in there more for like shared apartments, rooming houses, that kind of stuff. But you're right, as far as a bedroom, there's someone.
It may not be a good idea, just like it's not a good idea to smoke in bed.
But you can.
But, you know.
Yeah, the cooking, I think, is a good idea.
That's all right, I understand that, that's pure safety. Shall we get rid of the eating?
So, I think that makes sense.
Well, yeah, I'm gonna be laid up for 3 weeks. After this meeting, I'm having a glass of wine in bed.
You can't have ice cream while watching TV. Unless it's in the.
I understand it was silly, but I'm trying to think if there's an actual general reason why it says it.
I would object, I would strenuously object on principle. I would object.
Now cooking.
Cooking stays, eating goes.
Eating goes, yes.
Makes sense.
Please feel free to eat where you would like.
Thank you.
We have enough, you know, our freedoms can be abridged.
So while we're in that section, can we back up to number one?
Certainly.
Some of these, we had, or I made some suggested amendments to the original document, and.
Did we lose them?
I have one here.
I mean, in a different municipality.
The original document.
And, right, and, you know, that's going to city council, and I really don't know where it is in that process.
Oh, I see.
But one of the things under number one.
Required space and dwelling units.
Which was well received by a bunch of people. Overcrowding, and to have 150 square feet for the first occupant, 100 square feet for each additional occupant. The building code says the occupant orders one person for 200 square feet. So for this to be consistent with that, and that there is, you know, up front, more restrictive provision. So I had suggested that, or would suggest that we just change that to 200 square feet per occupant.
Say 200. For every occupant?
Yes.
Okay.
Leave the thing in there about the under 2 years old, but.
Right, but where it says.
250 or 200?
200.
Just 200, so it should be consistent for everything.
Yeah. Along those lines.
So we don't want it to say, and 100 for each additional occupant.
Correct.
Just 200 for everybody.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
And then moving along under overcrowding alone, which is number three. it goes from, for some reason.
Our numbering is not good. Yes, we'll fix that.
Number three, it goes from square footage to cubic feet.
Oh, yeah. It does go to cubic feet.
And I think we keep the overcrowding of rooms, you can just reference section 2017-01-13-A1, which is the 200 square. Because I think the initial one is, you know, this establishes the regulation. Then if we find that the regulations aren't being met, then overcrowding comes in.
So I didn't quite follow how we should change this one.
Okay, I just thought we should, to get rid of, may order number of persons, blah, blah, blah. There shall be not less than one person for every 200 One person requires 200 square feet.
So use the same language as above.
Yes.
Will you give this another look when we're...
Yes. Oh, that's right. I couldn't figure out how to...
I'll wordsmith it.
Okay. Because in Google, I couldn't figure out how to do what you did about suggesting changes that pop up.
Is a, yeah, it's a, yeah, don't worry about it. All right, let's see. Oh, then I went to Article 4, unless somebody has, you know, anything before. It talks about inspection by the Housing Standards Board, and then it refers in the last sentence to, in the first paragraph, to the Town of Rollinsford Administrative Code. Do we have such a thing?
No, we do. I'm trying to ask that. Mm.
The position, let's see. So I think we should just get rid of it. We don't have it.
If we don't have it.
We don't have it. You know, if ever, at some point, we decide we need such a beast, we then see where we need to insert it.
It's typically referred to the collection of ordinances, but, you know, we refer to them separately.
Yeah. Okay, we'll just strike off. That was easy. Select board, we don't need to. Oh, I had trouble with 2017-01-23, service of notice. It was just a semantic issue.
Service of notice.
The Housing Standards Board will issue and cause to be served upon the owner every mortgagee of record in all parties. It shouldn't be with interest, with an interest in such dwelling. You're trying to get to everybody who might be connected with to be served. Housing Standards Board will issue and cause to be served upon the owner, upon every mortgagee of record, and all parties with an interest in such a dwelling. Isn't that how it should be?
But is parties in interest a specific phrase?
All parties, is that the legal phrase? All parties in interest?
I don't know.
If it is, then we'll keep it, but all parties in interest?
Yes. I think you're right. I mean, if you just, between two things.
Yes, with interest is fine. That,
sure.
With interest? Okay. I'll go on unless someone has a... Oh, yeah. 1-30. Superior Court decisions. I just think there's punctuation missing. Because there's the sentence was 3 miles long. Now I didn't follow it. I don't want to take up everybody's time, but maybe somebody can read that, Mike or Tom, and suggest how to make it clear. The same was true with exceptions and a couple of paragraphs down. 1-32 is this long run-on sentence.
Yeah.
And get lost in the shuffle of what it means. And that's it. So
I have one more.
Yeah, tell me one.
All right. Where are we going?
In words and phrases, Article 9, second to last page.
What is it?
Words and under the definitions of basement and cellar.
Do I have it?
section 34. So it's got words and phrases.
Oh, definitions, yeah, I'm sorry, yes, 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 yeah, okay, I'm there.
There is a difference, and the building code does reference the difference at all between basements and cellars, but this, if it's less than 40%, it's a basement, because more than 60% is a cellar. But it's 50%.
Yeah, I was with you. There's a little gap there, isn't there?
So I'm just thinking we should change both of those numbers to 50, so that a portion of any dwelling located partly underground but having less than 50%, and then the other one would be a portion having 50% or more.
Yeah. Right. Then there's no gap.
Great.
Perfect. Thank you.
Sure. Before I give up my seat, do we want to talk about the septic?
Yeah.
I sent I sent you guys a copy of the application that the state requires via email.
Okay.
And number two, fourth line, municipal prior approval required. And I know in other municipalities, it's done on a regular basis, and the state won't accept it without that. So we're pretty much mandated. I mean, we could not do it, but septic design is probably part of the why, and we'd have to explain to the state why we're not, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Or, because we have to do it, and there are staff time involved, I think it's we should charge for it. We all, you know, we've done enough of them, and it's an administrative fee, and I know others...
You were suggesting, what, $50?
It's just like a building permit, you know, electric permit.
Yeah, yeah.
That's better than public hearing, not at all.
Or not. I really don't care.
Are you, I mean, if we're asking Tom to look at them, and we should be asking Tom to look at them, apparently.
Yeah.
We charge everyone else.
And being approved by you guys.
Well, we stamped them, that doesn't mean, yeah.
The way it was explained to us by a previous board member was that it was a pass, that we just stamped them and acknowledged that we received a copy of it. Come to find out, it's really, we're giving approval.
The guy, the designer cannot submit it to the state without that.
That we know.
Quite the way it was described to us.
We were told that we're sort of, that we're rubber stamped. It says we've seen it.
That's obviously not.
I mean, we've just, here's the application, yep.
Well.
So we should be doing our due diligence. I mean, we're not just the past. We're not just
I mean, there are, of course, standards and guidelines, and the septic designers are aware of them, but we haven't found any since I've been here doing this, but I know there have been issues discovered, you know, they had to go back to the septic designer. For a change, so it's
would
not
you
like.
That?
In the ones I'm thinking of, I think so.
Okay.
But I don't recall that instance happening in the long
term. Let me say this: certainly the I didn't stamp very many of them. The two or three that I did stamp.
I stamp them all the time. Joey stamps them all the time.
I had no idea.
We thought we said all we had to do.
But someone told me to all you need to do is stamp it. I said, "Aye, Captain," when I stamped it.
Well,
we can continue with that.
Well, I would prefer to follow state regs, to be honest with you. I mean, you know, I did my oath of office, and I would prefer to, you know, do what we're supposed to do.
But by standing and going through what we're supposed to do, even if we don't review them, you're doing what we're supposed to do by just acknowledging they're here.
But there's the difference, I think, between acknowledging and...
What does it say on the application? Just acknowledging, or what don't you do?
Municipal approval required.
Yeah, that I've never
seen. Sorry?
That I've never
seen. Oh, yeah, that came right out of the DES website as part of the application process for new and even replacement septic systems.
We'll review them and we'll set up a public hearing so we do establish a fee. I don't know, 50 is a magic number, but we should charge to cover the cost of it.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Any other questions for Tom for that?
I still get the stamp on me.
Yes.
Of course.
We wouldn't take that stamp away from
you. There's one in there, but I mean.
I know I have my stamp out.
All right.
One last thing.
Yes, sir.
not made anything, but I received my official appointment as health officer of Town of Rollinsburg from the state.
Congratulations, Mr. Clark, congratulations, and thank you. Do you have your badge?
You're welcome.
Do you have your badge?
I don't, it's a little card.
You should have a badge.
Do you want it in paper, or do you want to call duty?
No, thank you.
Okay.
No, thank you.
Thank you for doing it.
Yeah, we appreciate it. Thank you.
I'm just gonna, what, oh, sure.
There were some light, yes, so maybe we should have Chief Lightfoot come up, because we can talk to.
That's fine.
The chair is nice and warm.
Thank you.
Well, Mike, you know, it came up at the Rooney House.
There was an email from Tom, I think that resolved that, right?
Yes, but we brought it up publicly, so we should at least say that as a, that those questions had been, that place had been visited by a team, and the issues have been resolved. So that was.
We had a conversation today with the building owner.
Just today?
Yes, this morning.
Oh.
And just following up, and right here is the last official report done by the fire department on the property, with all the proper and in order violations which they needed to correct. But as you can see, that's dated at 09. Okay? We've been back one other time, that's the official one that's been signed on. That's done under the life safety code of the 2009. I don't know if you've seen anything that's been in the news lately, the state is trying to adopt the 2015 standard. There's been some things in the papers about it, because it usually come out every 3 years, 9, 12, and now 15, so the state is still trying to catch up also. And it kind of puts people that are in the fire safety business behind the eight ball all the time, trying to look at which code do I go. So the state needs to adopt what they're going to do, and then it comes down to our level, and we would adopt. We run off 09 now.
Was it 09 or whatever the.
Whatever it was, he brought us up to 09 when I got on the board.
It was, okay.
Oldest 15 was coming, yeah.
Okay, I did, yeah, you're right, and that's moving forward, but you know, I mean, it's been a while.
Thanks a lot.
It's been a while since we've been in.
So, I'm confused, is the rooming house okay, or do we, it is okay, all right, thank you.
The rooming house, yes, that portion of it is.
Okay.
Three-story building, they are just using the second floor. There's nothing on the third floor, there's nothing on the first floor, okay? So that's the only place that they have anything, and these violations have been met, they've been taken care of, so it's to the level that it should be to meet our needs.
I'm giving it back to you, because you knew where to find it, and so you should.
I have more copies if you want it, if you need someplace to file it, so you'll have it, if not, I'll keep it. But we have it, okay, that's fine. That's fine, because you had sent me an email about that, and I was kind of wondering what started that. That place has been a constant headache for a long, long time. In the last few years, it has finally kind of settled down to the point where on one of these inspections, we actually brought the state in, because there was people that were living on that second floor that were massive, I mean massive hoarders, to the point where you couldn't even make a pathway through it.
They came up in conversation because an abutter or some adjoining property was creating a water issue for them, so we.
They actually contacted us because of a drainage issue from the abutter.
So Michael Free associated and said, oh, whatever happened to that blah, 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 none of us, we didn't know, so we said, let's ask.
We didn't know there was actually anyone living in there at the time. And then it was it the tenant that brought it forward or the landlord? I don't remember who it was. A reference back to their one tenant that saw something, we said, well, they're supposed to have tenants.
So we thought we would follow up.
Do a due diligence.
Thank you.
We go through our files and the paperwork.
Are there any questions about this issue from either our health officer or our chief of police? All right. So I think, are we good with that then?
Thank you.
Super. I have a health license issue, not with that house, but with other houses. You have to go by that code, and I know that you have to have egress out of certain rooms in house in apartments.
And how many units are within the building?
So what happens if you have a unit in a basement?
That means you need it.
But I don't think those windows qualify as a.
Some of them don't, no. An old building, there's definite sizes to what you need to have.
Are they grandfathered?
For egress windows.
Are they grandfathered on the life safety? Okay.
But anything where you have to do renovations, new construction, then you have to follow within the provision.
Okay.
And those codes. Yeah, that's a good question, because there's windows you can't fit out of, and they're supposed to be that way.
Okay. So we would pick that up if they came for a building permit and.
Yes.
But in the meantime, they're just grandfathered, they're.
Yeah, I think it'd be a similar situation if someone with a bedroom that has a window doesn't comply with egress regs now, we can't say to them, you have to replace that window.
Right, right.
Unless they're doing some sort of major work, and then it steps up.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
Just curious as to.
No, it's a good question. There's a lot of that in this community.
Right.
Look at that size of the age, the houses and some of that we deal with, yeah.
Okay.
No doubt.
All right, well, thank you for following.
Okay, I got some follow-up for you too.
Okay.
Your roads, your class four roads.
Class six?
Class six. Wasn't it four?
Six.
Six. I dug through all.
Uh-oh, you've already passed the guidelines.
I know you have, but I just wanted to throw it back to you again, and let you know that I did a little more than revise it.
No, I just wanted to show you what we had.
We've got some of it was, we had these same issues come up with the Gagnon Hill.
Yes.
We had a long discussion with that. The one that they want to put in off of Clement Road is another one. Then we went in, and there was that sidewalk that was down there talking about Hammerhead, the clearances and stuff weren't exactly right. So I still have the same discussion and the same provisions that we had before, where we pulled out a life safety. And I also found one, I don't know if you even went that far, with a state standard, or with the state wants to do. I don't know if you guys dug that far and wanted that one or not, but I got copies of that.
Well,
since you said you already passed it.
Well, but wait, though. We passed something for class six roads.
Six roads,
not,
yeah.
Which would not be a development. So, and actually they do refer to the minimum road, state's minimum road standards.
With some shoulders.
Exactly.
And gravel.
So it does refer back to that. This is another issue that is worth pursuing.
And the planning board chair, one of the first meetings we had, we discussed things we'd look at for this year. This did come up, so.
That's the latest.
So, do you think the planning board might invite our fire chief to talk about roads, or do you
when
think it's?
When it comes to that point, yeah, okay. And the chief of police.
Yes.
And the road agent.
Yes.
All three.
Very good.
We just haven't gotten to that point yet.
Okay, I need something for you people to sign.
That's what we're here
Michael
for.
Michael has not seen these, I don't think.
We talked about that, I couldn't get it to open.
Have you seen those?
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
I guess you all have, huh? There's another one, you all have one.
Well, we can show the.
Anybody else want to look at what the new fire truck is looking like? Charlie?
Good, huh?
Yeah.
Cool, get it.
Very nice, nice chassis.
Thank you, Mark.
Yes.
I couldn't get it to open on my phone, and every time I didn't have thought about it. Go back and look on the actual.
So,
great.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, I think it's looking well. As you can see, there's no. If you look right behind the cab, that's where the pump will be placed. That's the next stage of the building, is where the pump is placed. After the pump is put into place, then comes the construction of the box. This is the drawing and the blueprint and the specs of which we sat down and prepared. I need you, all of you, to sign across the bottom. That this specs has been approved by the select board. That's going to go back to Jerry McKay, the towing rep, and then once it gets to him, it goes back to towing, and they start building.
And are you okay with the specs?
Yeah, that was my question.
That was a question all three of us have. Because,
say, sure.
You know, septic systems and fire engine designs, neither one were wrong. They've been in my passage.
I don't know septic and fire engine designs.
No, I think that's why I occupy the
seat. We'll just take a peek.
That's fine. It's basically what you're looking at right there. Is like I said, you can see the cabin. If you look right there in the middle, you can see that one section that has all those little black, those are gauges and whatnot. That's where the pump panel will be located. So the guy that's operating the fire truck stands right there and water in, water out, and does all his magic as he's standing there. Mm-hmm. As you go back towards the rear wheel, it has those three sets of doors. Those are roll-up type doors. Those aren't doors that are going to lift and swing out to you.
Yeah.
They're going to roll up so that we don't have to worry about being standing in the road or have something to clean them off and whatnot. So roll-up is the way that we're going to go with that. And then And then you can also see above the pump panel, there is, that is gonna be where our lighting tower is gonna be. We're gonna have a large tower that will come up telescopic, so it'll go up and we can light up the scene like falling. And it's got a generator which is located right above that first compartment, so you can see where some of the things are starting to fit together. But once they get this, then they start building that. And this right, this section right here, because we're still talking our mid-December date, this right here is about a 60-day build. So once they get this in hand, we're right where we need to be.
Oh, that's got a lot of good stuff.
I can't read any of my glasses. All right, so board, I don't think we need a motion. Are we ready? Are we okay for us to sign this just by consensus? Okay.
We all sign it.
So, do you want all of us?
No, you can do it, because as we did when we came in with Jerry, we sat down, whenever there was any changes that needed to be done, it was done as the select board. So that would, whoever wants to sign it.
If it's more change order kind of thing, then yeah, let's just.
We haven't done any change orders?
Not a change order, okay. I just say, okay.
This is just more of an approval.
Okay.
Approved by Rollins and select board, whatever you want, and offer goes to Mr. McKay. Oh, yeah, I'll follow the hands tomorrow. It'll be in Iowa shortly thereafter.
Please do, just initial sign, whatever you would like to do.
Just initial, that way we're on board.
I have one more thing to talk to the board and you about before you screw it out. Has to do with home businesses. Home businesses. We shouldn't have stayed.
I didn't know, I, yes.
It's on the agenda, I pointed it out.
Thanks.
I circled it.
Thank you.
Exciting, yeah.
Well, I finally put some, you know, I've seen some stuff online, but this is the first time you actually see some, because that's, if you look at, what color do you think the top of the fire truck?
Gray.
It's gray, it's not white. We wanted to have a little bit of difference. Everybody's white over red or black over red.
That's fine, that's great.
So we kind of, as an organization decided, let's change it up.
And all the new trucks going forward and the uniforms.
That might be for the next day on the site.
Fair enough, but that was.
I know.
That was your heart.
I'm starting to say that myself.
I know how long and hard it was to get this one here to this point.
Fair enough.
And I'm thinking, well, by the time that next one rolls around?
It took a while for all the trucks to become white. It will take time for them to change another uniform.
I'm a little bit of a traditionalist that way. There's some people that want to do it red, but we have white fire trucks, and I can remember numerous times this past winter, in the middle of a snowstorm, being out on Rollins Road or Roberts Road in number four, at an accident scene, and I couldn't see the truck from here to sound lights and everything, like it's snowing so bad, it was white.
White is, I know.
And it's like, just disappears. And it's even been like that when they come down the road to back into the fire station, all the lights go on, it's like, are they back yet? Because it's just, so to me, it was also a safety issue. But I wanted to get rid of all that, that whole white thing just didn't fit for me. After witnessing that multiple times, so we went that way. Our command vehicle is due any day.
Very good.
It's en route from Jersey or someplace, is the last word that we heard today. So we're hoping to see that within days. And as soon as that comes in, I've already talked to Caroline about it, that'll be taken care of, it comes to us. And it's going to be shipped two-way for outfitting.
Maybe next spring, I don't know if there is a particularly appropriate day. It might be nice to have an open house with, you know, showing off the command vehicle and.
You can count on it.
Perfect, that's great. Be kind of fun.
Yeah. Well, it's just a way to say thank you to the community. Otherwise, it doesn't happen unless you have the support of everybody.
The kids would love it.
Yeah, touch a truck thing and whatnot.
Even the big kids.
Yeah. Oh, we plan on letting people know that it's around. You want to ride?
I have no need.
Ride around the alleys?
I don't need, but I know some big kids who would, so.
Anyway, then we will definitely be promoting it. You know, as we move forward, once it's in service and we have whatever event we have, that'll be at the forefront.
Excellent. All right, thank you very much.
Welcome, anything else? Okay. Do I need to hang around and get some more stuff? I should listen to them.
It's up to you.
I will, I have a little bit.
So I did have something on the agenda to talk to Tom about. So it won't be long, honestly. So I happened to be looking at Halloween a lot, because they were talking about the paper. I went to look, and in the process, I went by it because I was distracted, so I turned around on Highland and came back onto Kelmont. No, not Highland.
No, Highland is out of town.
Pinecrest.
Yes.
A certain person?
Yes.
Okay. It, you know, there are vehicles, there's stuff, and I know that we have, there's nothing in our ordinances that allows us to address that once we're told that there's no business there.
Right.
So, however, this is a question for the board, and I'm just asking you for your own input because of your experience with this. I would like to ask the planning board through our, I would like to ask our planning consultant to advise us and recommend what we might do to change the zoning ordinances so that there's something that would help us to make that better.
I think that's a good idea. I remember when we discussed it and there's some ambiguity between home occupation and home business and...
And it kind of slithered through
right.
and in between.
Right.
And nonetheless, and if I'm looking on Kelwood Drive at that backyard, it's not pleasant.
It's right.
And this was with trees fully leafed.
Yep.
So.
I agree. I mean, it's, there's, I agree.
All right. So then if the board are you okay with mine sending an email request to John Krebs just asking him to.
Just look into it?
Yeah. And talk to the planning board with recommendations, potential recommendations for zoning. Any of these things would have to go through the right, all of them. Process. Jody, are you quizzical?
No, I'm just thinking of other places that, is there a list of home businesses in our town?
Well, we've handed out.
Like, we have massage places, we have daycares.
It depends on the size and the scope, and how many employees.
Photography.
Yeah, they all fall, they fall under two different buckets, don't they?
Right.
So is there a
in
list?
Home occupation and then home business, right?
So
there's
supposed
to register. You're supposed to register.
Okay, where does that list?
You are free to ask. Check with Caroline and see your time.
I bet you the chief has it. He has everything. No.
There isn't. As far as I know, there is no list like that within the town.
Okay.
Oh, goodness.
But they were supposed to register.
If we look at the...
It depends on the type of how they're classified, I think it depends on if they have to register. I don't think they all have to.
Okay, well, what has to register?
You have to look at the ordinances.
Yeah,
well, my book hasn't come in yet.
Maybe we'll table it.
Touche. Why don't we table it?
Why don't we table it? But I still will ask John to
look
at that, and if there's some ambiguity between those two that we should address.
I think it's a good idea.
Okay.
And we can start a book.
Registrations, yes. Very good.
I know it's being tabled, but we may want to consider a separate permit process.
Like, we had a fire that had an illegal daycare, and so we don't, two years ago now, so we don't know if they're if they ever reopened or not, right? Do we know? I don't know.
Well,
I would be careful.
Talking about one in Kelly.
Yeah, I don't know if it was necessarily an illegal daycare.
Mm-hmm.
It might not have been licensed by the state, but if they only have so many kids, they don't have to be, right?
But
and if it's zoned, it could be zoned. It could be permitted use in that zone, though, too. So
yeah, I don't know the details
of
that. But anyway, we just want to ask John to look at our ordinances that talk about these sorts of things to recommend any. You know, if there's a gap or a loophole or whatever.
It may well have been, but I don't know if that's great. Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
But if there's no list, we don't know. Yeah.
Chief Ducharme.
We maintain a list downstairs of all the regular business, Crown Farms, Janko, but not the home businesses like Hair Waves on Cricket Lane or.
Or
any massage place or something like that. So.
Yeah. I think we don't. And you know, yet our zoning ordinances say that, you know, they need to
right.
follow these things. So it would be nice
There's a lady on Silver Street that wants the old Berry house that wants to put a home photography studio there. So she keeps coming back and trying to work out details. But everyone does that. Some people just
do it.
Put out their shingle and they have a business like the one on Rollins. at one point.
Okay, I have two purchase orders. The first one is the two-way communications, purchase order number 1269. When I had you folks sign the prior purchase order for the grant that we got for the e-ticket system, I did not put the installation on there, the installation cost. So for two cruises, I've got a max of $500 installation for the two.
Coming out of the police budget, right?
Come out of the police budget, yes.
So.
Well, no, I mean, it's on a grant. We're covering that.
We're covering that.
Purchase order number 1269, two-way communications for the installation of e-ticket systems in cruisers 71 and 74 for up to $500.
Second. Any discussion?
I didn't mean it came up that way.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
No harm.
Okay, the second purchase order, number 1270, made out to Quality Response Systems. We have found that our AED cartridges are out of date. And people now tell us they're out of date. So we need four downstairs. We've checked the one over here on this wall to get that out of date as well. I'm going to assume at this point the one in the library is probably out of date as well because we bought all those AEDs at the same time. Yeah. So roughly $70 each. So I'm going to order six for $420 from one of our supply account number 505.
What about the highway?
Or
is that not?
They may not have one.
I don't think they have an AED.
I'll
check. But we had a grant. The lieutenant got a grant for us for these.
Okay.
And I know that there was an issue about the library or something, but we did finally include the library. Yep, so it's here, and what are the spots again?
Four cruises, upstairs here, and the library.
The library, yeah. But I'm not sure. You can check, but I think not.
Okay. Move to accept purchase order 1270 to Quality Response Systems for six adult smart pads for the AED cartridges at $70 a piece for a total of $420.
So it's very kind of the police budget to cover this. Is that the appropriate spot for?
Well, I didn't know if you had a line item up here to cover the.
Yeah.
Up
so I guess most of them are yours.
I can live with.
All right. We'll do it. We'll do it.
Yeah,
okay.
So.
Fine. All right, I'll call a question then. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And Will, thank you very much. It does all come from the same pot. These are final analysis.
Okay. All right, as far as the radio upgrade is concerned, all of the cruiser radios have been replaced along with the Bluetooth units, and they work marvelously. The guys can walk about 100 feet away from the car. Instead of the line in the portable, it's shooting right to the cruiser radio up to dispatch. So it's increased our ability to hear and transmit with dispatch immensely.
Right.
We're now just awaiting the arrival of the portables. And we're still waiting to hear the final authority from the folks at Homeland Security about our grant for the repeater system.
The one that's going up
on the water tower, yeah. Right,
so that warrant article, a $75,000 warrant article, covers all of
the radios and the repeater.
Okay. Again, I do have control with all these.
We'll keep it on.
Thank you. Very good.
Like, we'll
excellent. Do the best you can.
I got the official word Friday that Officer Hancock has been accepted to the SWAT team. He passed all the tests with flying colors. So,
and he wanted to serve, right?
He wants to be on the team.
That's excellent.
So we're pretty excited about that. So now we have someone on the county SWAT team. We have someone on the county accident and reconstruction team. So we're pretty excited about that.
Please congratulate him on our behalf. And thank him.
And I had a conversation earlier with Jody on a mirror for the highway department for their compactor.
So this is what they want, though?
Well, I guess I would suggest the 12-inch one, you get much bigger. I'm a little concerned that, because they want to stall right inside the hole there, or the entry for the trash, if it gets too big, you know, someone's going to be putting stuff in there, they're going to be hitting the mirror and so I think a 12-inch one might be sufficient.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
They'll just have to jerry rig somehow to mount it to the inside. Well, I even talked to Armin today, maybe they want to put it on a swivel. So it's actually inside the unit when it's closed up, but when they open the business and the doors are open, you can have to just swivel out just a little bit, so you can actually have, you know, a better line of sight from that room to the mirror inside the compactor.
So this is a mirror that they need because when they're ramming the trash can, they can't see the ramp. So, and there's colors on the ramp that tell you how deep you're going.
Got it.
So from the old one, you can actually see it. Obviously, you're way above it. From the side, you can't.
Yeah. All right, so that makes sense. So this is a recommendation on the size of such mirror.
And the company.
Reliant.
So,
okay, perfect.
Awesome, so I can just give this to Caroline, she can order one for us. It's $37.
We don't have to be concerned. Very good. You can use a credit card and everything. Excellent.
Okay, the last item that I have is on behalf of the Space Needs Committee, on Sunday I sent the folks the RFP that the committee has been looking at and putting together. As of our latest meeting, anyway. I guess at this point, if you have any questions, if you have a chance to review it, as I mentioned to Suzanne on Saturday when we were speaking about this, this really doesn't obligate the town to do anything. It's just out there to, one, to see if anyone's interested in the project for us, two, find out what it's going to cost, and for that cost, what are we going to get. So that gives us a point of discussion to either have a public hearing or have discussions. As we go through the budget process between now and March or whatever, to see if it's financially feasible for the town of Rollinson. So.
Right. I'm breathing more easily now. It just, you know, sometimes when you actually know that something's coming, it's like, oh my God.
Oh, sure.
So, but as I thought about this, it is helpful to know, what are we talking about? We're talking about this. And so, and I haven't read it yet, but I will be reading it this week, and I hope the board can read it this week, and we can have a conversation about it next week.
Okay.
And, you know, then assuming that we're good, we'll just issue it in the channels that we use to issue it. And we can also choose to send it to some people that we know have a particular interest. So we generally publish it on our website, and what we've done with Rhodes, and also send it to...
Yep.
You know, certain companies that we are aware of. So I know that there have been some that you've
there are a few that have sent us information.
Yeah, there are two that are interested thus far.
Okay. And is the search committee, so did the space committee have any dissenting opinions?
The only concern was that we hadn't looked at the possibility of sharing a space with another department. Charlie Putnam graciously.
Outside of the municipality.
Correct. So, for instance, thinking of the city of Somersworth, the city of Dover would allow the town of Rollinsford to rent space within their police stations. So our police department could operate out of that station.
Mm-hmm.
Dover doesn't have any room, and I believe the city of Somersworth isn't interested.
Is
not interested.
Well, it's
the city
council
apparently isn't terribly pleased with us. So.
What?
The city council and some of the departments are very pleased with Rollinson because we took our children.
Well, it's an unusual.
He pulled me aside from my song on the public and he said, hey, you know,
they're holding
Rollinson. And you go, beep, 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 you know.
Be a regular resident in Rollinson and we hear that. Like, I hear you at the softball field.
It was a good move and I'm sure it struck some residences.
But at least we asked a question, so someone later on
asked,
did you at least explore?
Exactly, it's always good to ask the question.
These will be the answers from the other communities.
Yeah.
And we also looked at contracting services out, and it wasn't you're not gonna get the same level of service, and it was as expensive, or in some cases more expensive than what you're getting now, so.
And the issue, which is of course what happened with Somerset, what happened with, what is continuing to happen with Marshwood, is that once you do that, you lose control.
Exactly.
You know, because then your choice is, you know,
there was also a desire
no police
to see
services or police services.
Yeah, right. There were some folks that said, well, why don't we just, we have more in common with South Berwick, why don't we contract with them? It's just, it's not feasible crossing state lines.
I would love to do more with South Berwick. I think they're, you know, they're smaller, you know, they're not, they just seem more, that we have more affinity with them. It's just,
sure.
It's really difficult.
In this case, you just couldn't.
No, I understand, you know.
But that was something, another question that may come up,
yeah,
that we also looked at.
Crossing state lines can be problematic.
You
know?
Can do it for schools, and there are statutes that allow that. This is not,
right,
this
is not
an emergency, he
yeah,
can cross lines, right, and help, and vice versa. But
yeah, we can't transport people across state lines.
Understood.
Willingly or unwillingly.
Yeah, understood. But we've asked the question, so that's good.
Right.
Now, the were there other, I mean, you're suggesting a location.
We
is
are,
that,
yes.
Is the committee in agreement with that? Is that more?
Majority of the committee, as I would say. I mean, it's still an outstanding question as to whether or not, did we ever hear back from the Wentworth family?
I have not. I put a little blurb out there to the Wentworth families, and maybe a land swap, he's here, he's
yeah,
there.
Yeah.
Right.
And they were going to talk to the patriarch of the family, and I didn't get to hear back. So
right.
We're about a month and a half now.
Yeah. I mean, this is not new. I said it to you. I probably have said it to the board. My concern about Silver Street is I worry that there isn't sufficient room for growth. And if the demands placed upon a police department change, you know, with state standards, federal standards.
Room for growth for a police station, I think. But not, you wouldn't be able to, you could add a town hall upstairs if you want. Be very expensive to add on after you've already built it, but I mean it could be done. But so there's room for, you could expand for police needs, right? You could still room out back. You could, there wouldn't be room to add on like a whole town hall feature though. So there is some room for growth for police services.
Okay. I should probably go look at the site myself.
And the only issue with, like say for example, going to the Wentworth property is that they don't have town water. So you have this town water at the Renew Tech, but that comes in from the backside of the water tower to the woods that way, shorter run. By not having water in the well system, might not support a sprinkler system for that building. That was the issue with the water being on the water line, on town water line.
That does make Silver Street more desirable in that sense. You still have the issue, of the railroad track too, being on the other side.
Well, nothing will be perfect, sure.
But depending on what side of town you're on, you're on the opposite side
that
of the railroad tracks.
That is true.
Yeah, right, exactly.
True.
Somebody's on the wrong side of the
tracks.
Yeah, that's true.
So.
All right. Well, thank you, and we will read it up. I plan to read it this week.
And certainly, if you have any questions,
absolutely. And thank you and the committee for the work involved in doing this.
So, that's all that I have for you folks. Anything for me?
I'm going to need you for transition in a couple of weeks.
Sure.
But that will be for a couple of weeks. All right.
Yes, if you will introduce you to our new road agent, as we will our fire chief and our building inspector and everyone else. It starts the day after Columbus Day. George.
And just one more thing on the budget.
Yes. Thank you.
Small
thank
matter.
Susanna had asked for all the departments, some department, I've done that. And for a number of years now, the folks in town and even some of the board members in the past have said, rather than this show each individual line item with a straight across the board percentage of pay raises. Maybe there should be some type of merit-based system employed in there as well. And I certainly agree with that. I've agreed with that for a long time. So the question is, how do we do that so it doesn't show up on the line, as a line item each year, for example, I saw user chief, everyone else have, for example, 3% pairs, but chief had 1% pairs. Someone reading that may say, well, gee, maybe the chief didn't do a good job this year, so the select board's at 8, you know? So to make it so it doesn't look disciplinary in action or impact them negatively publicly, certainly they can ask and they can get the information. But rather than throw it out there and say, this is I've created a line item that says merit and put a line item in there. So I've left all the increases for 2018 000 and taken 3%
of the
total and put it in that one line item. After the budget passes, the department heads can sit down with the select board and say, you know, I think because of this reason, this officer should get this amount, this officer should get this amount, this officer should get this amount. And so their pay raise will come out of that one line item, so it won't show up, you know, as an individual officer. Having said that, we might even want to consider combining all of the officers' salaries into one line item. So instead of having, you know, the chief at 50, the lieutenant at 61, blah, 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 going down, you just have one line item totaling everything.
Salaries.
The salary line item, right. And from what I understand, it's actually an easier job for Caroline because she's just taking all the salaries out of one line item now instead of going, well, here's the chief, you know, here's the lieutenant, here's the overtime, you know, and whatnot, so.
Now, of course, I suggested this last year.
I don't remember, but sure.
I
do. I didn't like it
because. You
were not the only one. You were, right. I'm getting pointed at, okay. I don't remember, but I'm sure I am.
I understand both sides, but from a resident, when I look at the book, isn't that a kind of like a right to know kind of thing? Because like Dover publishes every single employee.
Which we could do. But we don't have to put the increase over last year either.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you can't, and the school does that. So there's a salaries line in the school, and then elsewhere there's, this is the teacher
right.
and the compensation or salary, this is the teacher and the compensation.
Right.
So we could do the same thing, we could certainly do it to the,
right.
so that.
Like I see both sides, like I wouldn't want my entire building knowing my pay raises.
And if somebody, you know, from the public wanted to find out with them, particular pay raise was and what the salary was going to be for 2018 for a particular officer.
Right.
I mean, they have the right to come down here and ask either you folks or myself, and we have to give them information. I'm just concerned about just blatantly putting it out there so Officer A looks at his line item and Officer B looks at his line
right.
item. Well, how come? You know what I mean?
Right.
And we had a question a couple of years back where there had been a mistake made at some point.
Exactly.
And some the officer was associated with that line said, well, I didn't get all of that.
Right, exactly, yeah.
You know, and so it's just a difference between, you know, a budgeting, accounting, and then also just the public right to information. So we can accommodate that by just listing our officers, the compensation, in a separate page, but not right there, right in the budget, just have salaries. And we can, just salaries, and we can say that this was the full-time salary base, and this is the 3% increase, or you know, it's a 3% increase over last year, however we decide to do it, but I recommend that sort of consolidation. So you can think about it.
Back to, so back to the school budget, it is just one line of salaries. And then,
for
and
teachers, anyway.
For teachers,
yeah.
Right, right. I might be prepared, so I don't remember, but, and then
another
elsewhere,
line.
Right, another line, but
yeah.
elsewhere in their budget, there was a description. In the budget documents that were passed
mm-hmm.
out. You know, teacher, first grade makes this, kindergarten makes, I don't think it's like the name of the person, but
mm-hmm.
the position,
yes,
what they make. So
well,
that's in the town, that's published. It. So.
Yeah,
and
I'm saying we can publish
just the accounting
we can
purpose.
Do that. We can publish that. That
right.
So that's my, it's
right.
not a
it's
question of trying to
yeah,
hide
right.
it.
Right.
It's just a question from a budgeting and accounting point of view, it's
yeah.
much simpler.
Right. Right.
And then, and so let's say we do what we do this year, with 3%. Next year we know what that base is. We know it's right there. So if we want to attach a 2%, you know, that you can then apportion out, or another 3% that you can apportion out. It's just one, it's one calculation. You've got 8,000 or 8,300 to use. You know, larger institutions do often use salary base.
they'll say, okay, we're gonna do, you know, 3% of the salary base. Department heads, you can use it for anything. And, no, they'll say 3%, 1% is gonna be across the board, the other 2% you can use for merit and or bonus and or whatever. You know, reclassification, you know. So it's just a, I think, a good way to do it. But think about it, we don't have to make that decision. We'll have our first workshop, I think, this Saturday?
Saturday.
Saturday, yeah.
Yeah.
We're calling you.
I'm calling you.
Yes.
If I fall asleep, I will. I'll be on later then, so.
We'll take you as long as we can get you, how's that?
I'll be on mute unless I have the time then.
So I like that idea, we'll see how it transpires, but I really like the idea of the providing, you know, using merit. And you're the one department where it makes sense, because you've got really some full-time people.
Right.
And more than one, and, you know, so thank you for.
And we actually have.
Recommending that.
Yearly evaluations on our arm.
Yeah, so that's the piece that's critical.
Exactly, yes.
So what's something to think about for moving forward, is this isn't part of our personnel policy, right? So we want to update, if we're gonna do this, we're gonna want to update the personnel policy to say that we have merit increases.
I think it's already in there, but we didn't have the job descriptions. I think we had put the cart before the horse.
Okay.
So.
I'm not sure that there's anything in this conversation that is contrary to what's in the personnel policy.
Okay, well, I don't know that for you. So that's what I'm saying, I'm not saying you're not telling the truth, I'm just saying I don't remember that, that's all.
Yeah, feel free to, take a peek.
It sounds like a good idea, I want to make sure it's covered, so if an employee has a question about it, they can refer back to it.
I don't think the personnel policy talks about across the board or merits, talks about having a evaluation process,
okay.
But it doesn't talk about across the boards or merits or just says we should all do the evaluations and thank you for doing that.
One department does.
Yes.
And did you get the job descriptions for everybody?
Mm-hmm.
I sent over.
All I have is the ones that you gave me. That's it. Nobody else has given me anything.
Okay.
It's still on the list to do once I get them. So.
Yeah.
So I get transferred on.
All right, thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. You too. And thank you for the spaghetti dinner on Saturday. It's delicious. I'm sorry I forgot to take a container back home, but
that's okay.
Next year.
All right, take care.
Take care.
Bye, John.
Bye, John.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Welcome.
What is the next item? Go ahead, because I'm still
bringing it. Transportation position, it says.
Alright. So we have hired George Gimlet as our transfer station, as our road agent. Well, that's not what we're talking about. Transfer station, you said, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. That's the Saturday one. Jody, is there anything to say about that?
No one's applied.
Alright. So we'll keep it open or resubmit in a couple of weeks or something?
Oh, definitely keep it open. I'll have Caroline repost it so it falls to the top of the list again.
Okay. All right, I do have the agenda in front of me now, so I do know that the next item is transfer station fees, which I believe you've asked to put back on it.
I actually put back on, I'm speaking with the front, and they feel an increase is recommended on their end, and they're willing. I'm like, well, I don't know how the town would feel about that.
An increase in of the $10 fee?
The 20. So, and it is one of our highest expenses. The transportation does not break even.
Mm-hmm.
So, bags in Dover and Barrington has to have a sticker and a bag.
Mm-hmm.
And they still deliver their own trash to the transfer station. So, and their bags are $1.20 a piece or something. They recommend 20. They understand that they will
take the brunt of it.
And they're happy to take the brunt of it.
Brunt.
There were maybe some blunt too.
Yes, that's what I was thinking.
I think the blunt is the stick.
Yeah, exactly.
Blunt object.
So they asked me to ask you to revisit it.
So do they need that before they order the stickers? The stickers don't have the price, right?
No.
Okay. So I believe.
And they haven't determined where we're gonna put the stickers either.
I believe that's a change to the transfer station ordinance. We may be able to do it ourselves, we'll need to look at the ordinance. I'm not sure. I mean, by ourselves, I mean, without a public hearing.
We had one last time.
If you're willing to.
Well, I'm gonna, yeah, we need to look at it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, even if we don't need one, we still like choose to have one.
Yeah, we did have one last time, I don't know if we had to, but we did have one.
So did, what about a second sticker?
Across the board, $20.
Wow.
Wow.
I thought they were pretty great.
People were, or some people were very angry that they had to pay $5 for the additional sticker.
Mm-hmm.
Watch that, it's sort of.
All right, well, we'll, let's think about this. We do have some time, right?
They will sell them.
Starting
November 1st.
All right, well, I would like to read the ordinance. I'm, we can talk about it next week, okay? So we'll.
We don't meet next week.
Pardon?
We don't meet.
Two weeks.
Two weeks?
Oh, we do meet next week. You're right. We do meet next week.
Yes. If you wanna be buzzed in, you can let us know.
You get a reprieve, that's okay though.
You can just, right, you get a reprieve. All right.
But then the following week, we don't meet, right, this Columbus Day?
Yeah, correct.
Correct. Okay, well, thank you for that. Thank you, I'll just say.
That's all of us.
All right, stop signs. Is there a purchase order?
There is.
So do you wanna set the stage for that?
Sure. So they, Wayne's been working around town, he has a list of signs. Two are needed currently, but the sign people, the barricade people, New England Barricade, only have one in stock. Apparently there's a run on them because we have to upgrade them all. So they will not order less than six. So we need, I think, what was it, 25, 26 anyway. So Wayne wanted to order the six to at least get the two that we really need and then start working on the others.
So the total for that is?
So they're $85 a piece.
All right, well, let's move it and we'll talk about it. So,
okay, purchase order, we should accept purchase order 1305 to New England Barricade.
Sorry. Okay. So you're looking at the budget, I think the budget for signs is $1,600.
$1,600.
$570.
And we, to date, I think when I looked at it, we had spent virtually nothing in that line. From a budgetary standpoint, the highway department is in budgetary crisis, shall we say, because of both equipment and vehicle repair and maintenance. So, however, what was the total? 570? I mean, this falls within the budget. I don't think I didn't crimp anything from that line in order to make it work. So, you know, this is a case of not this year, then next year. So, you know, it's still three digits. I mean, I'm willing to.
I'm leery.
Okay. Do you, what would you like to do?
It's not the top of my priority right now. It's I have to find staff. I have to get ready for snow. The signs that are there are still, they're not reflective, but they're there. It's not like there's no stop sign. So I really think we're gonna.
I can be persuaded to hold up.
Yeah.
So I
appreciate Wayne's effort. He's doing his job. He's doing it diligently. He's doing a great job, but the budget isn't there right now to support.
Will you relate
that
to him so
yes.
At least he knows that we are appreciative of this? We don't want him to stop doing this.
Yes.
We will do it.
Yes.
Okay, good. Lynn, are you okay?
Do we have a stop sign in stock at the moment at the highway department?
No.
No.
Not one that's legal.
Do we normally stop them?
Not one that's legal to put up because they all have to be changed of that. So they all have to have that new reflective stuff.
Right, no, no, no. The email earlier today said that New England Barricade had one.
Yes.
We didn't buy the one, so we have one in reserve.
Yes, yes.
Could we, we try to keep at least one or two on hand because they get damaged in the wintertime, so just to have it.
I didn't know we actually stopped them.
We used to. That's what I'm saying, we have one now. If we have like one of the older ones, I'm fine with that. If we don't, maybe we should just to have. If we keep them on hand because they would get damaged throughout the winter.
We look closely more at the, yeah, carts and stuff. You look closely more at, like, I see maintenance over budget, I see
salt
over budget.
Oh, yeah, it is, yes.
Oh,
I mean, I've rebudgeted. I've already grabbed dollars from other lines, and I didn't grab anything from the sign lines, but that doesn't mean that we still won't need to, because here we are in September.
Right.
And we don't know what the winter's, what the winter's going to bring to us. We're going to, I need to find budget dollars to cover the difference between George Gilmet's salary and...
Okay. So we just don't buy the signs?
I would feel more, I wouldn't mind putting it off.
Put it
until,
off, but...
Until we get maybe some better clarity. I mean, and the other possibility that we don't know yet is any overrun in the culverts.
Yeah.
How many do in particular with the construction oversight?
We're like a very great kind of restock them.
At some point, yes.
It's not like we're the only one.
Oh, right, they just won't do it right this very minute. So.
Do you want me to change this purchase order to one sign?
Well, if we already have one at the highway, sir, I'm fine. Even if it's not the new reflective.
Okay.
But if we don't have one, we should think about next week. We can think about order just one instead of stuff. There's another company you used to go to, though.
Mail order,
something
somewhere.
In
yeah.
Tennessee or something, right? So I wonder.
Well, it was mail
Kentucky
order. It's maybe Kentucky. Yeah. Somewhere. Yes, and they were somewhat cheaper, even sometimes with the shipping, but
yeah.
You had to
right.
You had to check.
Right.
So. All right. So. Thank you for the information. We've just voided that purchase order. Is that the appropriate
move?
All right. Stop signs. Okay, transition. So road agent, there we go. So we've hired George Gilmet to be our road agent. He starts the day after Columbus Day.
Mm-hmm.
With regard to being in transition, once he comes on board, we are still in transition now. Once he comes aboard, I consider us to be in transition for a number of weeks, whether, I don't know what the magic number is.
Right.
So Jody, would you be able to continue to manage the transition once George is here?
Yeah, the nice thing is I'll be recouped enough where I'll be driving, so
I can
hang out for a couple hours and do what I need to do.
That's beautiful. And in particular, training, where things are, what the things we consider to be his responsibility and how to go about doing them, all that sort of good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. I think Caroline was going to, I don't know if she did, I think she was going to open up a shared document for us and her, so that as we think about things that might need to be addressed, whether it's just managing purchase orders or whatever, we just add them to that list.
The Municipal Association have a training for road agents?
Well, that's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. We do know there's the Road Scholar, so
right.
We can get a hold of their training, their list of training, and make sure that's available to him. And especially whoever does the green snow
right,
pro.
Right.
Well, definitely we're coming in so late that we have to get plowing. Is because the day he starts, it could salt. The day he starts, he may have to salt. So
yes, so you need to know.
I want Mike Dion offered to help, and so did Al Johnson. Offered
that's
to
nice.
Help go around and show him the roads and stuff like that. Because we have so many tiny little side roads.
Mm-hmm.
I had hoped and asked that we have the routes documented. I think all we had was a list of roads.
Yeah.
And not really this to this to this, you know, one, go from here to here to here. So that didn't happen.
No. Mike's working, Mike was gonna be work, Mike Dion out was going to be working on that. I have to reach out back out to him. I'll probably do that meeting this weekend.
He should at least know his route.
Oh, he knows his route though.
And what did he drive? Did he?
He drives a little truck. He doesn't have a CDL.
Oh, so he drove the Ford?
Yeah.
And this way he does the village and the smaller streets there.
My street, all the little ones.
Yeah.
So,
Okay.
Stop sign, transition.
All director positions?
Nobody has applied yet, so we have Caroline, three folks to be done. So I'm very surprised, so.
Well, maybe we can ask George too, if he knows.
George said he did know some people and he was gonna reach out as well.
Okay.
So, very excited about that. And then transfer station improvements, they're working on the warming shed right now. They were doing some woodwork on it today. Townsend's coming in tomorrow to talk about the heating tank. Apparently they only fill the other heating tank once a year. So it doesn't need.
It doesn't use, yeah, it doesn't use much.
So, and they're gonna make it pretty tight, a little bit of insulation. They're really, the guys have been very resourceful at the transfer station. They're like, oh, I got some insulation at home.
That's great.
So they're okay, they're doing great. They're compacting the cans and I only got one statement, but from one, this is the first month that we've actually used the two cans and we saved $1,200. We only made three runs. Yeah, $1,261.
That's right.
We made three runs in August on the 2nd, the 9th, and the 23rd. And they're still trying to calibrate the ramming factor. So they can hold, we used to ship about 9 ton. We're up to 14 ton. They think it can hold, the driver says it can hold about 19 to 20 ton. But of course, the guys are like, well, I don't want to break the equipment.
Right.
So, right. Cause, so they're watching the dial
along
because
right.
The RAM shows the dial. So they're calibrating that. Atlantic was over today to check on the wiring and making sure, because they didn't feel it was ramming as hard as the old compactor and they wanted it checked.
Okay.
So they're over there. As far as the covers that you guys have talked about,
Jeff had talked about the compactor or the canister of the compactor needing a cover so that we weren't compacting a lot of water.
Right. So that goes under the old compactor because it's an open chute. But waste creates so much heat that any snow or ice that gets in that one, it's melting out. Because they're not completely sealed. They do have a water.
It's coming out the bottom.
Dredge.
Yeah.
Same thing with recycling. Recycling doesn't have, they're not watertight either. So they are compacting down recycling with the backhoe, but that isn't watertight either. You do get a little bit of ice in the wintertime, but the snow's gonna melt during the day and stuff, but that doesn't generate heat. So, but you would have to create a roof so high that you have to get the backhoe in there along with the arm moving up and down.
Oh, yeah.
To compact it.
So you're talking about something taller than what's already at Town Hall, at the highway shed.
Yeah.
So you're talking about like one of those giant buildings like in Lee.
So
that
probably
height.
Not
it's
practical
not,
for a next step.
Right.
It's not on my radar.
Yeah, got it.
The cans are on my radar.
Well, talk to us about the cans.
So the recycling cans, we need recycling cans. Because to get it off the ground, we have we got the grant from NRRA last fall. We got the two recycling cans. They're not being used for recycling right now, they're being used for demo, which is wonderful and saving us demo, but the grant stays there for recycling. So they're gonna put tires and probably the metal or the refrigerators or something with the coolants in them or something. But in, and so I asked for a quote from Atlantic for two more cans.
To be used for demo.
To do, right, correct.
Yep.
So, and then in the.
Did we get that quote?
No, please. I just sent it off this morning.
Okay, yep.
So Russ is now aware of it. And then once all that's done, the stickers go on those cans and these are recycling.
And we have a place for them for 2 minutes?
Yep. Yep, they're gonna be over on that back wall where the tires are and stuff. And actually, they said it was actually gonna help them because they can't see that far over. So if they're over doing something over in the building or by the compactor, and someone just drives in and drives out, they don't know what they did. So we may not be getting all the fees that we could be getting, tires and refrigerators. Russ was interested in taking classes at the NRA to see what more can be recycled. Can you separate the wood and where that would go? Can they turn it into press board?
That's great.
And things
That's
like that.
That's wonderful.
He's really interested in that. So he's going to reach out to the NRA and take some classes with them. Because they're free of charge to us.
They just want to encourage recycling. That's what they're in business to do.
We're going to reach out to them and the men are going to figure out.
Thank you.
What boards they want, because we got so many boards to use per year on those new signs.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't used any this year. Last year we bought our big one.
I'm excited that they're thinking about all of these things.
They've been great. They've been taking the reins. They're doing a great job. And Wayne has been awesome. He weed whacked. They were supposed to do roadside mowing today.
Can you remind, because I thought we should put it on a website too. So it was supposed to be this.
I don't know what roads are going to be roadside mowed though.
Oh, okay. Yeah, all right. Never mind.
Guy that we hired to track the program.
Yeah.
So when are they going to do it now?
Next week. Next Monday.
Okay.
So in the meantime, Wayne just.
Sligo is one of the roads though, isn't it?
I'm assuming.
Yeah.
I have to assume. Yeah, I drove down there and it's getting.
A resident of Sligo said so. I assume because we have no road agent, we're not doing roadside mowing this year. I says, oh no. We've signed the contract, Jeff arranged for it before he left. So I couldn't remember when it was. So it was originally this week, it's not happening this week, but it will happen next week, is that?
Next week, next Monday.
Okay, all right.
Yeah.
And because it's only certain parts of the town, we don't need to.
Right,
sorry. Somebody knows.
Well, I'm hoping Wayne knows. I'll double check. We reactivated his phone today. You remember he's using the track phone.
Yes.
He's not using the phone that the road agent had. It was out of minutes. So there is a purchase order or a check or something. I ran into Walmart, got him another 90-day supply for $40. So he has that phone when he's here. So he's in contact with them. And if the transfer station gentlemen have a cover that, remember when we used to have the paper? They used to cover that in the wintertime, and for the same reason of the snow. So they said they'll try to bungee wrap that over the recycling cans, because we have the railing, and then they have the ties on the cans themselves. So it could be just a little slope.
I like that they're thinking of all of these things.
So they're going to try that out and see if it works. And
that's excellent.
Has the CPR training happened yet?
I don't know.
Is it October?
It's October.
Are the transfer station employees going to that?
I have no idea.
He sent a letter.
I'm excited about the weed whack. But I will double
check. Me too. I agree with that. And demo cans and the like.
I can't remember. One of their spouses asked me. It's off. I don't know. She just heard about that. So I don't know what they're required to do. But the other town employees are, so it would be.
We sent them the email.
Okay. I had no idea.
So all town employees got that. I think it was a requirement.
Well, I said if they were required, they would be paid. So
yes, yeah. Exactly. And that they should ask for a waiver. We did get one request for a waiver from. All right, so, well, thank you. And I think if we have a purchase order for the demo cans, we'll get another balance on that, on the warrant, to make sure that, you know, we can cover it from that warrant, because that would be
okay.
Nice to do it. So thank you for that. The other thing, anything else?
No,
then I would just, I would just say that I would like to post something to the website just to announce this. So I wrote up a little blurb right before the meeting. It's very simple. It just says, the Select Board is pleased to announce the appointment of George Gilmet as our new road agent, effective October 10th. Mr. Gilmet comes to us most recently from the Department of Public Works with the town of Berwick. He has had experience in many aspects of road maintenance, and the board looks forward to working with him to maintain and improve our roads and to manage our transfer station operations. Welcome aboard, George.
Any aspects of the variety of.
He's had experience in many aspects. Isn't that the same as a variety?
Sure.
Are we good with that?
Fine.
I just, you would ask for a change.
Yes, I obviously, I forgot from the time you said it.
Oh.
It did say
I'm
all.
I'm okay with it, so.
It said all.
Did it say all?
Yeah, so I changed it.
I fair enough.
I just used many as a variety.
Just wanted to make sure you accomplished what you wanted to accomplish.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, so removal of shed, I think that I don't have anything to add.
He's not reached out to me yet. I don't know if he's reached out to Chief again.
Okay. Project, all right, so now we're in town administration at 8:37. Project updates with regard to the culverts. I don't know if you've been watching, but I mean, they're now on Pine Street. They closed off the road. I usually go once or twice a week just to see what they're up to. We're having a construction meeting this Thursday or Friday, you know, with contractors, engineers, et cetera, et cetera. I don't know that we have a final approved pay rec, but we're still operating under the authorization as long as, well, Tanner has given it its blessing. Any one of us can sign that pay rec. The Army Corps of Engineers, it's a post project thing we have to do. You'll be so happy to know that we're now starting to get closing documents associated with closing the loan. So we're getting it both from the USDA, we're getting it from the Bond Council. So that march of the official documents and red tape and whatever has started. So we'll have things to sign, and you know, our Bond Council said, so remind me when the board meets so that you can have the document signing. I told her every Monday except holidays. All right, we've processed the fire engine no cost extension of time to the DARA grant from DES. The other project related, it's actually a future issue with other culverts, is Sligo Road. So if you recall, we were approved for a grant that SRPC applied for on our behalf, is actually executing to see if what they can do to improve our ability to apply for grants for the remaining two culverts on Sligo. And so Kyle from Stratford Regional said that there's a notice of intent that if the town is interested, we would need to file by October 9th. It's a notice of intent that says, yes, we're interested in applying for the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program. It commits us to nothing. So, but if we sign it, so in other words, we have to tell them we're thinking about it. If we decide not to do it, that's okay, but you can't do it post fact. So, so if the board is okay with that, I will have a conversation with Aaron Coyle Tanner and Kyle of SFC to talk about the best way to get that NOI. And if the three of us can come up with what it is that NOI needs to say, it will come to the board anyway. The board will have to sign the notice of intent. So are you all right with my just kind of doing all of this groundwork with Will Tanner and SRPC? I will. I'm hoping not literally, but
that can do it.
All right. So I will proceed with that and keep you posted, as I always try to do. With regard to our tax rate, so Avatar has completed what they need to do with the MS1, and we're in the process of trying to print out the documents, see who has to sign them, and the like. So there's the MS1, the MS50, Beverly had to do, it's a list of our loans, and so she signed them, so I just need to upload those to the tax portal, DRA. I did, as I said last week, I worked on the estimated revenue projections, and it only required the preparer's signature, so I signed that and uploaded that. And we seem to be in decent shape with regard to revenues. So I'll keep you posted on those kinds of things associated with the tax rate. The 2018 budget, so we're having a workshop this Saturday, so I'd like us to think about, and that's what this is, the consolidated police salaries, we don't have to agree now, just think about it, and also consolidate under, like, I think there's a personnel section to consolidate our insurances. So one line for health insurance, one line for life insurance, one line for disability. That way no one can look at the insurance when we have these small departments and say, oh, look, so-and-so must have a two-person, or so-and-so, how come this person only has a single now? And you know what I mean?
Right.
So for purposes of privacy, this has been coming out in some listservs.
Yeah.
It would be better to consolidate some. So think about that, and we'll talk about it on Saturday.
Have we heard from the health insurance? I got a blurby letter.
Caroline's, yeah, I've asked, you know, for rates?
Yeah.
Yeah, for exactly, no. We should hear sometime this fall, we don't know yet.
Yeah, there's a blurb in here somewhere.
So I think I'm using about 5%. Did they suggest anything?
Nothing. Okay. All it says is a friendly phone number. In the coming weeks, health professionals will be sending more details about the exciting new services we are thrilled to offer. That doesn't help me now.
Right, it doesn't. Okay. Well, Caroline is on it and is trying to get, you know, she's not going to get Primex to issue rates sooner than they're going to issue rates, but,
right.
You know, we're in the process of trying to determine rates from a number of different places that are helpful to us. So I'm just, you know, in the absence of that, I'm using inflation factors. And whether it's sufficient, I don't know, but that's how I'm managing it, which I will see on Saturday. We're able to schedule a workshop for this coming Saturday, but we're unable to schedule any others because I think you don't have your calendar.
I'm up to date.
So if we meet Saturday, the following two Saturdays, I may or may not be around. So it kind of depends on.
7th, I will be available.
Okay. So are there. So I think we were looking at potentially at other evenings. Is that true? Or maybe early mornings?
I do have the 14th, 21st, and 28th.
Sorry, say it again.
October 14th, 21st, and 28th. Those are the other Saturdays. I wasn't sure if there's other things going on.
Oh, I see. Well, we can do. What do you think about the 21st?
I have something in the morning.
All right.
Actually, three things in the morning. Mm-hmm. Okay,
though.
Okay. I have two soccer games I'm meeting.
How about, an early morning, is that, you know, an early weekday morning, would that work at all for you, Mike? It's too difficult, huh? All right. What's the earliest in an evening that you might be able to schedule something?
Realistically, probably 6 o'clock.
So what do you think about the week of the 16th?
I think I'll be in Washington.
All right. Huh. Well, let's hold off. Let's see if I follow through with my travel plans. If I don't, can we tentatively schedule the 14th?
Sure.
Oh, no, I can't do that. Tentatively schedule the 7th. You can't do it. We're back to not being able to do it. All right.
21's out. Joey's got something. The 28th is out.
28th, I'm fine.
All right. Let's get to it. Yeah.
And we can do something before that, but
yeah.
Let's take
some time, like on a Monday night, just to maybe do something. So 9 o'clock again.
Yeah.
Okay, let's do that and see where we are.
You know, starting Monday nights, we could do 6 o'clock, Mondays, no, just do a half hour.
Yeah.
Just do a little more, maybe.
Yep.
If we have to.
Yep, that's a good idea. So we'll maybe do that right after the Columbus Day. Can we tentatively do that right now?
Mike's gone on the 16th, so that won't work.
And the 12th, it's Thursday night, just so you know, of the CIP.
All right, so.
The 5th and the 12th.
Yeah, so, but to follow through with Jody's suggestion. So we're gonna meet Saturday. Second, there probably won't be enough time in between, but, and the 9th, we don't meet. And the 16th, you're not here?
That is correct.
So maybe the 23rd at 6 o'clock?
Do some work on that, that's fine.
Yeah, okay. All right, we could do it, 6 o'clock, on the 16th, 6 o'clock to the 23rd. Okay, let's do that.
16th and the 23rd?
Yep. Well, we can, you won't be here for the 16th anyway.
Correct.
So for the 23rd, we'll have a better, we might be able to know whether we need a full hour or maybe a half hour works. So thank you for offering though. Let's keep that in mind. Okay, so that's the workshops. So, is there a new building in Classics Roads that won't get printed out? We'll have to, maybe we can print it out for Saturday. I'll have it available for Saturday. You may not remember, but there was a highlighted section.
Yeah.
Sentence. I will find it right now. What is it? Classics.
You reference the state or realm of.
Exactly.
Code.
Yes. So it was highlighted and it's.
You have it right here.
Thank you. I just found it too. So it said, Classics Road must be brought, the standards to which Classics Road must be brought are those set out in the roadway-related subdivision regulations initially adopted by the Rollinsford Planning Board in November 15, 1988. That was highlighted because that was when New Durham passed something called.
Right.
As you know, I asked John Krebs to give us verbiage, which he did, which is in that, it just refers back to the subdivision regs.
It doesn't have the date. Basically.
It doesn't have the date and just refers back. So, and this, the other sentence about New Hampshire Department of Transportation's suggested minimum design standards is fine to keep in as is.
Yeah.
So I don't feel that that requires another public hearing, that's just a reference correction. So I'll print that out on Saturday and it would be signed at that.
So that, because this one has the date on it, you don't want this one.
Right.
Okay.
Yes, because that, we did, that's incorrect. That's when the town of New Durham did something.
Okay.
They adopted their approach
yes,
standards.
Yes, we did not do that. So it's just to correct that reference. Okay, so I'll have that printed out for us on Saturday.
I didn't see anything back from John Krebs.
Possibly sent it just to me?
No, I saw it.
You saw it?
Yes.
It was, I don't have email opened up or I would just
find it. I will find it.
It was sometime this past, last week, after, between now and last week's meeting. If you can find it, maybe you can, okay.
Yeah, none of us noticed, blah, blah, blah. I got yours. I don't have anything attached to it from him. This one.
Yes, yeah. he did respond. So I assumed he responded to everybody.
No, he didn't. Well, he would have. Did you email it to everyone?
Yes, because Jody has it.
Oh.
have Suzanne's going out, I don't have Krebs coming in.
Can you read what he suggested, you have it there?
Proposed language, the standards for existing multiple lots or dwelling units, two or more lots and or, that's all said. Right, now, isn't that the same, the standards for existing multiple lots, dwellings?
Yes, it was just the.
Okay, you want to, yeah. Shall be brought, must be brought, those set out in the Rollinsford subdivision regulations by the. The standards of existing multiple lots or dwelling units, two or more lots and or two or more dwelling units to which the class six road must be brought, are those set out in the Rollinsford subdivision regulations by the Rollinsford Planning Board as amended. However, the select board may apply the applicable road construction standards and the New Hampshire Department of Transportation suggested minimum design standards for rural subdivision streets. I'll be at the top of here.
That'd be great, thank you.
Are you for it? Because I was about to pull this.
Doing it too. Oh, you have a good one.
I'm right here, so you'll get it from both of us.
Okay.
Faster set of Kendrick.
While you were doing that, I got an email back from Michelle Small. When I checked in to see if 16 and 17 year olds can be back possibly next summer, our insurance company said sure, as long as you're using safety equipment. And they said, well, you want to check with the Department of Labor too. So I checked with Michelle Small to reach out. So Michelle Small sent me the link, and yes, they can. So covered.
Very good. That's good. Good to reach out to her. Nice to have connections.
Yes, it's like a little easier.
Okay, excellent. So that's class six roads. All right, SRPC, there's a services agreement.
Yes.
Somebody has it. I did check our IT budget, which is where it would come from. And we've reduced that budget by $1,000 already to put dollars somewhere else, but there still remains the money in that line in order to, for us to.
No chance they'd give us $1,000 in 12 weeks, right?
What's what?
No chance they'll let us pay it in 12 weeks.
Oh, you mean in
yeah.
Well, then we could end up having to pay it twice, though. So I think I mean, it's in that line. And so far, I think there are other pockets, if we need pockets, that I think we can maneuver. So this seems such an overwhelmingly good thing that we all thought. So I think we're good.
I know.
Okay, I'm moving
on.
I
get this way every year.
All right, let's take the plunge. We'll see if we want to take the plunge.
I'll move that we enter in a service agreement with the between the town and the Stratford Regional Planning Commission for Map Geo Services. It's set forth in the contract for the amount of $1,000 per year.
Second.
Any other comments or questions? All those in favor say aye.
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 We do have a comment.
I did too, but.
Oh, I'm
well,
sorry. I was
okay.
Very quick. Well, let's.
No. Go ahead and sign one. We'll talk. So. Just today I was in, and Caroline was stopped twice to go get tax cards. Just today.
Yeah.
So it happens every day, and that was half hour.
I think it would be an incredible tool for the planning board.
And also,
mm-hmm.
Very
helpful. There's more than one application, so
absolutely.
It would be great for dealing with
yeah.
tax cards, but this will be.
So just my signature and Cynthia will sign with SRPC. So you will put this back in the.
You see.
All right. Thank you. That would be a great thing. Facebook page. We already talked about that. Current use. We got our attorney up to date with where all of that is, and it. Sort of is in his hands, I think.
Okay.
Administrative support. So Caroline brought this up with me, so I will bring this up to you. There is about 3 hours a week, I think, of administrative support that she could use out of the line that we use for our recording secretary, line called administrative support. So Caroline is asking us if we would allow her to hire somebody for the 2 or 3 hours a week now through the end of the year to work specifically on organizing the files of her office, in that office, not. And that part of the issue now with filing is that there still is, I don't mean still, is that things are, don't flow well. And if there were better structure to the file organization, it would be easier to keep up. So it's not overspending that line, it's using up the balance of funds in that line to do some additional, to do administrative clerical support, which is what that line is there for. It's just not in the person of Salmon.
So why aren't you doing it?
Because I don't want to put the time in.
Oh. Alright.
You're still doing the other duties, other things that you would do.
Oh, I am.
It's just not additional.
What we need to do is organize those files. No one knows what files there are or where they are. And it's ridiculous. You can't put your fingers on information at all. So what I started was to start identifying all the files, where they are now, and then, but it's very time consuming because you have to look at everything.
Yeah.
You're fine.
Just to have somebody else do that. And then Caroline can look, say, okay, this is what we have, this is how these guys should go together and put them physically together and just have a nice organization. And then you can go, once you have them identified online too, because we have a filing spreadsheet, you can then know what we have and easily find things. Right now it takes a long time for some things.
So you do filing, like you're doing like the building permits and the filing that you do, but you're talking about like the
but there's certificates
of
insurance,
I got you, okay.
And all the things that go with the culverts.
I got you now. There are things in multiple locations, I'm guessing.
There are three major file cabinets
right.
That need
okay.
to be reorganized.
That makes more sense to me now. Okay, I got it.
I don't mind that, but not at this time, because it's going to take away Caroline's time, because they're going to keep stopping Caroline and going, where do you want this?
No.
She's asking us.
Someone's going to be tasked with just finding out what's there. Then later on, she will. Of course she will. But she does that all the time now. But,
The request came from Caroline.
I know.
So it was her suggestion.
So we have to hire this person. Background check them. Because they're going to be dealing with sensitive materials.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there will have to be a background check.
Can we do it in January?
Well, the money may not, well.
The money's there now.
The money's there now. Well, we can wait till after the quarterly report, and that will tell us, where we stand. That will still give us, a few weeks if it looks to be okay.
Because this is, do they plan on doing it like on a weekend?
No, I think it's during office hours.
No, it's when she's here.
Okay, and are we going to put out a application?
I don't. Well, that's a good question. But because it's not really a, it's really just a, it's just a temp. So I think that we can relax. I don't know that we can relax the background check, but I mean, as far as if she knows somebody, I mean, it's like for
30 hours. I mean, for the season, 32 hours.
Yeah, for the entire spread. It's just that's the amount of hours available across.
Well, you want a table until the quarterly report is done?
Yeah, I'm fine with that if you're sure to get more comfortable.
Mm-hmm. When's that due?
the quarter ends this week, I think, but it'll probably be another week and a half.
No.
Okay, very good then. Old Mill Lane Bridge, just placeholder of historical committee?
Yeah, they'd like.
They have something here, we tabled left.
Oh, that's DOT, yeah, that's DOT, I'm sorry, yes. That's a, we're, I've already said we were tabling that, so I'm sorry. We're at the historical committee.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right?
They would like to have a, an account with the trustees of the trust fund, or aligned with the trustees of the trust fund, hold them up.
And is that kosher, is that what?
That's what Mr. Dumay suggested.
Suggested?
So we need to figure out how we do that, that's all.
Is it a revolve?
Non-lapse, yeah.
It's non-lapse.
So we need to figure out how they would get.
Authorization to spend.
Yeah, I think, somewhere.
So.
Agency, right, to withdraw funds from it.
Yes, if that's allowed by our.
Right, yeah, I don't know, but it's.
Yeah.
But this seems, this is the easiest way versus creating a heritage commission and then having to set up a fund that way. And that's a much longer process than we're not ready for, so.
So let's say they raise, let's say the committee raises like $500. So once a year you would, where does that money get, the money has to be deposited. So the town would still have to, we would, Pearline would be depositing those funds. But at some point, they would be transferred over to the trustees. Trustees and trustees?
Yeah, we think so.
You know, normally the, they get their funds from us, you know, we were, you know, there's this transfer, transfers in, transfers out.
That's the issue.
Right, it's the, it's sort of the, did he didn't say special revenue account, he said trustees of the trust. Yeah, no, sure, he meant that, just.
I could be misremembering.
You know, it's just that we don't deposit to that.
Right.
You know, once a year, we'll say, okay.
We transfer.
Yeah, here's the CIP money, here's the revale money, blah, blah, blah. And then they come back, okay, here's the money you're authorized to spend, you know. So there's the, it's the transfers in and the transfers out.
Maybe we can ask Tom about a special.
So I.
Account, or a special fund. Is it better to go that way?
I don't know, I just know that Beverly. So Beverly.
He gave us guidance before, I don't remember.
Oh.
That's the problem, I can't remember, but this was, it was easier than going the other route, I don't.
I mean, there are also something called special revenue accounts. And those are under the treasurer's control. So the special revenue accounts that we have are hydro.
Right.
And the LUCT, the land use change tax fund. And I think we just added another one.
And they need to be created by town meeting.
I would say.
Yeah.
Possibly, that seems, makes sense. But, so as we deposit, you know, Beverly knows, so Caroline would deposit and then she would tell Beverly, okay, that's.
Where it goes.
Right, that's what I.
That's fine as well.
But I don't know if that's what he meant. But that has a more fluid or easier sort of deposit thing if you're not doing it all.
Right.
At one time.
The idea is that they want to have a non-lapsing account, so if they raise $1,000 this year.
Sure, that
makes
sense.
Going towards, say, the Perry Yard School to move it.
Yeah.
Donation, sale, whatever, grants.
Yep.
That we can actually keep that, you know, house that money somewhere.
Understood. Understood, so I would just say we need to determine whether it's.
Yeah.
Special revenue or. Okay.
So we'd like to turn it over to the select board.
To explore?
To do that. They're making the reform request, they want to have either a special revenue account or align with the trustees of the trust fund, whichever makes the most sense. So that they have a place to house the money that they raise. It's currently, it's just going into the town down the fund, right? And they haven't raised much, but.
Right.
Yes, and it lapses.
What they like to have lapse.
Not lapse.
Non-lapse, that's what I meant, thank you.
That's, I have to think too, so. All right, very good then. Joint loss, job descriptions, we're gonna talk about that. Welfare, I think that's just gonna be in the back burner until we get some of our budgeting and other kinds of things, so. And I guess we're ready to go with standing items, is that correct? All right, board member activities and updates?
I gave you the first one, that's the historical committee.
That's right.
But also the historical committee, they're looking to do a walking tour in late October, early November of the old Dodge Farm property, including the pest house. Into the Bunny Trestle Bridge and then the pest house.
Pest house.
What's left of it, which is just with a hole, foundation hole. So at one time, every town had a pest house or island in my Portsmouth case, where they sent people with smallpox. They would go to the pest house.
Yes, of course. Isolation.
Yes.
Okay. Cool.
And we have one.
Yeah, well, there you go. Okay, Jody?
The rec committee met last night to work on their budget. I sent you an email, they're probably gonna need a little extension. I didn't think that was a problem.
Yeah, that's okay.
I spoke at a turn for you guys and so I think we can handle that.
It's okay.
But they're trying to figure out a good price point and better quality. And so those two have to jive and they're gonna work on that and then bring it back.
Okay.
So they're gonna shoot for this Sunday, they're gonna email it, if they can get it done this week, email it and then have a quick meeting to adopt it to bring to you guys on the, whenever we meet after the lunch.
Okay.
And if I'm not here soon, he's throwing it at you. If I can get it done by then, if not, I'll present it to you. And then you heard everything about highway and transfer and.
Yes, and thank you again for managing all of that.
Joint loss meets in a couple of weeks. Gotta get a couple more job descriptions out there. And that's about it, I think.
Okay, so I met with the Seacoast Stormwater Coalition last week and we're, the group is really sort of coming together over the kinds of things that we can use group process to do. So you'll hear more in the coming weeks, but this is the group we've put $1,000 into the kitty. We're about to get some stuff back because of our process. And then this week on, I believe it's Thursday morning at 8 o'clock, there's a construction meeting right here with Boyle Tanner, Parker, this is like the last time. USDA is invited, they haven't shown up yet, but they could, they have every right to. And I will keep you posted with what comes of that. I don't know of any issues at the moment. I know that something happened at the lower mill as they started at the river and backed up to the storm drain. And as they got closer to the storm drain and there were pipes that were not on that Dixie didn't know about and that no one knew about. And Brian just happened to have been this morning, Brian Hellerum, and he, if we're talking about the same thing, there were steam pipes that have just not been in use since the 30s or 20s and stuff. So it turned out not to be a big deal.
Right.
And but it's, you know, it's a surprise and they kind of have to wait around and they're not able to be productive while somebody's trying to figure out what the heck it is that this pipe is. So I guess that's it for my activities. So let's go on to the folder work then.
All right. First item we have is the certificate of occupancy for 470 Church Street.
All right, board is okay with my signing this? It's approved by Tom.
Eversource for pole licenses. They're in our right of way. first is located. Between 3543 Sligo Road. Next one is, no, it's the same thing, there's just three cops that are assigned.
So what, there is no pole there, they want to put a pole?
Correct. Public Service Company of New Hampshire, also known as Eversource Energy and Northern New England Telephone Operations LLC, and Fairpoint Communications, Northern New England, request a license to install and maintain underground conduits, cables, and wires, and maintain poles and structures with wires, cables, conduits, and devices thereon, together with such sustaining, strengthening, and protecting features as may be necessary along and under the following public ways. License one pole between 34 and 43, located on Sligo Road in the town of Rawlinsford. So it's either new service or it's replacing an old, probably an existing pole. They need to have permission to do anything in our right of way. So.
We have to sign it in three places.
Eversource doesn't get lined up coming just now. No, that's Eversource. They don't know. They're off. Next is for Jody. It is a sewage disposal system reviewed by Mr. Clark for 216 Summersworth Road.
I saw it come in this morning when I was here.
So we need the town clerk to attest to this?
She gave it to me. So she handed it to me tonight when she came in for the.
Oh, okay. So she left on
her. One more. You ready, Tommy? Next is building permit 2017-104, 31 Wentworth Street. New construction, reviewed by Mr. Clark. There's a fee of $1,925. Next is permit number 2017-106, 415-417 Second Street. They are replacing stairs and railings, first and second floor and second and third floor. Concrete estimate attached. Oh, it must be the building association, I guess. Fixing. Oh, that's the back stairs. Okay.
Is that your group?
It's the house next to us. I know. They actually told me about it over there. Yeah, they're replacing the back deck, part of the stairs, just the risers and the stairs. On the first, second, third, and fourth floors. Second and third floors of the deck. So Mr. Clark's reviewed it. It's a $55 fee. The next one is 2017-107, 11 Cricket Lane.
This is a septic
on
as well.
Is there a septic on there too?
Yeah.
So there was a second one?
On the
Wentworth?
Schindler.
Yep.
So,
okay, so
it says new construction, but there's a septic to go with it.
Okay, so you looked at it.
So. Yeah, I looked at it. Yep.
Well, Tom
did. Did my thing.
All right.
But it doesn't have the paper to go to the state, and there's no free copies either.
Hmm. Okay.
So. You should just put a post-it and know. Let Tom and Noah know.
Sorry,
go ahead.
So tell me, it's 2017-107, 11 Cricket Lane. They are doing some interior work to finishing the interior of the apartment slash breezeway for garage addition, plumbing, electrical, insulation, sheetrock, etc. Part of the plan here. Has been reviewed by Mr. Clark. But attached garage on second floor accessory. Okay. All right. So it's an accessory dwelling unit that's attached to it. So that's okay. That makes sense. So it would be, it's allowed by law now, so. Is it an existing one now, or is it one that they want to add?
How much is it now?
Oh, it's $55. No. Where is it? No, it's not. He has $25 here. It's reissuing a building permit that had expired, apparently, is what it says. So it's already gone through a review once before. So they had to, Cricket Lane, okay, it did go to the planning board. I wanted to make sure there wasn't like a new project happening. I remember we had one on Cricket Lane last year, I think it was. So, all right, he's just reissuing a building permit, so. It's $25 now.
Mm-hmm. 25. Did you get that?
If it was a new one, they would have to go through the view of the plan. Mm-hmm.
So what are you reading?
Pardon? In the back, where it said.
I'm
telling you, I have super glasses now. I'm telling you.
It's like invisible ink. He's looking at us. Oh, so, you know.
Can I?
Can you read any of that?
Yeah, that's it. Attached garage with second floor accessory dwelling.
Yes, that looks like a blank piece of paper. He looks just so good.
It would be if I didn't have my glasses on.
All right, next.
I'm done.
You're done.
I'm done.
Okay.
That's enough. I think show's over.
Okay, you gotta sign this up.
Oh, I was so taken by the blank, what I thought was a blank piece of paper.
I can have the other one back.
Yes.
It's time to figure it out.
My turn?
Yes, your turn.
Okay, so HealthTrust sent us some information. They're going to be offering, looks like, flexible savings accounts effective November 20th. And November 1st, 2017, they also have an email. And employees and administrators will be able to access the new.org and the benefitadvantage.org through email address November 1st.
Do you get information from HealthTrust by email?
Do I?
Yeah. I mean, I periodically they will send things. I just assume
I get,
that
like,
everybody.
Meetings and
that all
classes.
Of us are on, not just. Us, just staff and, yeah, okay.
Yeah, but they're going to have special classes on, like,
yes, this topic or that topic.
Like HR for the non-HR,
okay.
Was that them?
Yeah. I mean, some of the things, what it looks like, I think we all get it. I don't bother to forward.
Okay. Xfinity sent us more information. Municipality emergency reporting procedure reminder.
Something reporting. Reminder.
Municipality emergency reporting procedure reminder. I have to assist municipal customers. We are writing once again to provide you with the emergency reporting procedure for certain outside plant and service problems.
Maybe we should forward that along to our director of emergency ops.
The chief?
Yes. Emergency management. He's the director of emergency management.
Okay. Move to accept purchase order 1280 to Green Shadow Property Maintenance for one mowing at New and Old Town Cemetery with mowing and trimming. This is the eighth mowing for $1,345.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 So this is a list that they keep updating of things that they're getting done at the highway. So you saw Main Street was being waxed and
Mona, the Pattersons were very appreciative.
Oh, great.
Thanked us.
So they did Church Street today. They're doing the sidewalk, but they're not going inward towards on the other side either. But we'll work on that next year. And they went down, they started on South Street too. So I'm hoping to go up South Street and down all those individuals in the meantime.
Nice.
That's definitely.
And
I went in front of our house, but I took her with her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's one weed growing out of a telephone pole that's a bush at this point. So on South Street. I was like, oh my. So
there's a maple tree growing in front of the no parking on street sign on Cross Street.
Oh.
I think it's pretty sizable now. I'm gonna actually cut it down.
Well, as long as we're talking about things of this nature, someone, you know the Oak Street Bridge that has a weight limitation?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I'm sure it says it also, as you train, because I think I've seen one of them,
yeah.
But as you approach the bridge, there is a sign too, it's completely covered by vegetation.
Oh, well, there's also giant indentations where someone didn't heed the bridge warning. A giant tire.
Oh, I see. So, anyway.
And the wooden deck.
So I guess if it's on this side, if it's on the Rollinsford side, it's up to us to
trim it.
Yes, that's one of the roadside mowing that
I see.
I would hope that that's on the
yeah.
list, but
okay.
I highly doubt it because Oak Street would need a lot more
detailed work. Yeah.
So, but yes, I was driving down that the other day and I'm like, wow, this is all like when you're looking for those things, you find them.
Yeah, but otherwise you don't see
yeah,
them.
We didn't have not much specificity as to what was ours and what wasn't
right.
until very recently. So
right.
now we can.
And I happen to be living on that street. I happen to pull out of the driveway and I couldn't see from the overgrown garage.
Yeah, that could be dangerous.
Yeah. So Health Trust is having a public notice, public hearing notice. On rate setting and surplus returns for January 2018, but it's only in Guilford and Keene.
When is it?
Join us October 3rd.
Rate setting, so that must mean that they're getting ready to set rates, is
the
that?
The two public hearings are in Keene and Guilford. I super hope that.
I guess everybody else just drives to Concord to get them. I don't know.
I
mean,
at least Concord would make sense as central.
Yeah,
okay.
I don't know.
And everything else is old.
All right.
Yay.
Oh, so we have two things I forgot to mention. Building permits. They're very well may be existing permits for these properties, but there are two things I've noticed over a couple last week. 131 Clement Road, put in a new driveway. Or they redid their driveway, I should say.
It's not an additional driveway.
Not an additional driveway.
Yeah.
I should clarify. I don't know what that's about, but it doesn't. It's not like it was just
resealed.
Yeah, thank you. It was an actual like put in a new driveway.
All right. So you have the address
at 131 Clement Road.
Okay. So just forward that to Caroline. She's got a template she uses.
In 620 Rollins Road. Demoing the house and rebuilding it, so I don't know.
So whereabouts?
So if you were going to turn onto Summersworth Road,
yes.
There are two houses there. Mm-hmm. Not the one closest, not Mr. Brown's house, if you know where he lives. All right, so he would be the last house on the left, rather the right. It's the house before that. It's a little white house that's sort of set back behind his. And they're putting a whole new second floor on, so.
Oh, yeah, I haven't seen that come through.
I mean, it could have, I mean, maybe it came through when I wasn't here or that week, I don't know, so. You processed them, right, so?
Yeah, no.
You haven't seen them?
Well, I think since Friday.
So.
Yeah, so.
Those two.
Yeah, very good, good work. Just pour them along to Caroline, the address and. All right, are we good? With our stuff? Community input?
The driveway or parking on Church Street in the past has been in the, what I guess you would say drainage swale, or what the previous road agent would say, was issue driving through the drainage swale and parking in it. So I don't know if this new driveway will make it any easier or not on the drainage going down that way, but it may alleviate the parking that happens there. The previous tenants used to park right on this drainage area.
Yep, it is a challenge for the district, for all of us.
And then the question about trash cans and dumpsters there, in the past, they have a little opening underneath where they put their trash, in the trash cans. That's what I would, and then the SRPC map, map geo, will that include demographics? I've recently come across an issue where I'm looking for demographics of the community.
No, but you can, if you like communities in New Hampshire?
Specifically Rollinsford, like what demographic is school age, what demographic is working population, what demographic is retired.
Do you remember the company that we looked at?
Pick that scab some more.
No, but I mean, they've got, I think you can, some subset, some really basic stuff that's free. I don't know if the demographics was part of it. Where else could you find demographic data? I mean, if it's census.
State website, but they get it from us, the census.
Yeah, this, I was going to say the state, but the state really just has a total.
Right, the Census Bureau, I don't know what.
Yeah. You can take a look. You can.
Their website's set up.
SRPC.
Yeah.
Look on the SRPC website, Stratford Regional Planning Commission. Yeah. They've got a boatload of data. Mm-hmm. And if you can't find it, zip off an email. I mean, we as a community are subscribers, mm-hmm. and so zip off an email and see if they have that somewhere. They'd be the best bet, I think.
Okay.
And if it has to come through us, just let us know and we'll put the request.
The Census Bureau, is it by block? Is that what they do? Is that what they call a unit? Census blocks?
Yeah, I mean, they've got some really discreet.
They must have all of them.
So, yeah.
My concern was is I wanted pretty current data, and the Census Bureau would have data that's 7 years old.
7 years old.
And they're gearing up to do the next census.
Well, it would be a good thing to ask how. I don't know where
so
they may be using the same data. Yeah, so. But, you know, sometimes there are algorithmic, what's the word?
Formal
projections or extrapolations, that sort of thing.
So if we, I know you had an in-depth conversation about the non-lapsing account for the historical committee. If an account gets set up for them, will they have to do a budget line on a year-to-year basis, or will it just accumulate the money they bring in?
When you say budget line, what?
Will they have to make a budget request to the select board on a year-to-year basis?
Well, it depends on who's agent of it, so what the agency is, and whether it has to have an annual authorized request. So that, which is what happens with the trustees. That's why it's unclear to me how this works, because trustees of the trust fund, the town meeting, you know, we'll go to the town meeting, we'll say, authorize, you know, so much money, all of it to come from the revale fund or from the CIP, you know, or that sort of thing. And so that sets up the ability for the trustees to then transfer out that amount of money to us. Now, some of them, the board has agency, because it's better for how that fund works. But again, the town had to authorize that. we didn't just do it ourselves. So I think the eval fund we had agency for, because we knew it was gonna happen in midstream, and the
Hydro fund, I think.
Hydro's a special revenue fund.
But don't we have agency or whatever?
I don't think so.
Take out.
No, we don't. We needed a warrant article to do that, I think. Which we haven't used in years because the cutoff was 50,000.
That's a good point, yeah.
What was I saying? I lost my train of thought. But anyway, that's why we have to talk to Tom, because I don't know, I don't really understand a mechanism.
And my last comment was that there was a discussion that happened at a previous meeting when you were in non-public about teenagers mowing in the cemetery, and that they weren't sure if that was allowed. So Jody, I heard you found some information about roadside mowing for 16 and 17 year olds. Maybe you should forward that to the cemetery trustees.
We back.
But it might be something that the cemetery trustees could use to reduce their mowing costs.
All right, thank you. Anything else? Board, are we ready to call it quits?
Motion.
All right.
We're adjourning.
We're adjourning by consensus.
What time is it?
It is 9:32.